Yeah. الحمد لله نحمده ونشكره نستعين به سبحانه وتعالى ونستهديه ونستغفره ونعوذ به جل وعلا من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا من يهده الله فهو المهتد ومن يضلل فلن تجد له وليا مرشدا عباد الله أنصحكم ونفسي الآثمة بتقوى الله أحثكم وإياها على طاعته أحذركم وإياها وبال مخالفته جل وعلا ومعصيته أشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له ولا شيء مثله ولا شيء معه قديم بلا ابتداء دائم بلا انتهاء لا يفنى ولا يبيد ولا يكون إلا ما يريد لا تبلغه الأوهام ولا تدركه الأفهام ولا يشبه الأنام حي لا يموت قيوم لا ينام وأشهد أن سيدنا وحبيبنا وعظيمنا ونبينا وشفيعنا ونور أبصارنا وبصائرنا وقرة أعيننا محمد صلى الله عليه وعلى آله وسلم عبد الله ورسوله وصفيه من خلقه وخليله أرسله بالهدى ودين الحق ليظهره على الدين كله ولو كره الكافرون اللهم صلي وسلم وبارك على هذا النبي الأمين وعلى آله الطيبين الطاهرين ورضي الله عن صحابته الغر الميامين وعنا معهم برحمتك يا أرحم الراحمين أما بعد عباد الله يقول الله سبحانه وتعالى في المحكم بعد أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم إنا لننصر رسلنا والذين آمنوا في الحياة الدنيا ويوم يقوم الأشهاد. The ayah is in Surah Ghafir. And the ayah means, Allah says, إنا لننصر رسلنا. It means, we will give victory to our messengers. رسل, رسلنا, our messengers. We will give victory to our messengers. رسلنا. والذين آمنوا, and those who believe. يَغْفِ الْحَيَاةِ الدُّنْيَا, in the dunya, in the life. وَيَوْمَ يَقُومُ الْأَشْهَادِ, and on the day where witnesses would be allowed to stand. The ayah, again, it's short, this portion of the ayah, and as many of the ayahs of the Quran, sometimes they are short, and we feel that they are simple and their meaning is ingrained, but yet the meaning is very profound and very deep. And actually it touches all our life everywhere. إِنَّا لَنَنْصُرُ, we will support, we will give victory to our messengers, Allah mentions the meaning of that of the ayah, and those who believe in this life and on the day where witnesses will be called. Before we start anywhere, let's remember that Islam came to build the individual, to make this individual a decent human being, a productive human being, a positive human being, a human being that observes ethics, morality, values, respects human life, respects basically the akhlaq or the moral portion of Islam. Where Nabi Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam came to tell us, إِنَّمَا بُعِثْتُ, I have been sent to perfect the standard of morality. يُتَمِّمْ مَكَارِمَ الْأَخْلَاقِ, to perfect the makarim of akhlaq. And Allah Jalla Jalaluhu confirms this by saying, Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim, وَإِنَّكَ لَعَلَى خُلُقٍ عَظِيمٍ. You are indeed on the greatest of characters, sallallahu ta'ala alayhi wa alayhi wa sallam. This is one aspect of Islam. Why? Because building the human being takes two sides. Takes an internal side and an external side. Yani, what does that mean, internal, external? Internal akhlaq. You are born in a family where your mother feeds you morality and ethics. Your parents tell you, you cannot lie, you cannot steal, you cannot do this, you cannot harm other children. You cannot play with other people's toys, for example. As simple as these things. Huh? bringing you on the ethics of Allah, ولي الصالحين, ولي الصابرين, those who have sabr, those who have salah, piety, that Allah is with them. That Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, إِنَّ اللَّهَ يَأْمُرُ بِالْعَدْلِ وَالْإِحْسَانِ وَإِيْتَاءِ ذِي الْقُرْبَى. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala commands adil, justice. All these things are values that internally you should be ingrained with being born to a Muslim environment, let's say, or an Islamic family. Or at least that's what Islam teaches. Adil, justice. Ihsan, more than simply justice. That you are, see, justice is that you treat people an eye for an eye, that's just. But Islam doesn't only stop at justice, goes beyond justice to al-ihsan. That means you are good to those who are not good to you. You are good to those who are not good to you, because Islam expects you to be good to those who are good to you. At least that's a basic, decent human value. وَإِتَاعِ الْقُرْبَى, also taking care of those around you, those of kin, those who are near to you. وَيَنْهَى عَنِ الْفَحْشَاءِ وَالْمُنْكَرِ وَالْبَغْيِ. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala forbids الفحشاء, those who say bad words, those who say bad things. فحشاء has many different kinds. Those who treat people badly, abhorrently, bad words, filthy words, that comes out of there. Character assassination. Fahsha. La. Dealing. Ayat al-Munafiq 3, the Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, the signs of Munafiq 3, إِذَا حَدَّثَ كَذَبْ, when he says things, he lies. وَإِذَا أُتُمِنَ خَانْ, and if you give him an amana, you tell him something, don't say this, this is private. Or you give him an amana, literally betrays the amana. وَإِذَا خَاصَمَ فَجَرْ, وَلِيَدُ بِاللَّهِ, and when he disagrees, he becomes fajr. No, nothing stops some people. You see that? Islam treats things based on what we see, reality. You treat people, Allahu Akbar, as you all know, all these things, everything, but then when there's a disagreement, nothing stops. No, Allah stops them. Yeah, the rules of Allah does not stop them in that sense. Allah stops everything if He wills Jalla Jalaluhu. But the rules, the codes that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sent, revealed on us, do not stop them, nor do the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam's order stop them, nor do morality, nor not even laws, nothing stops them. We see these things. We see these namadaj, these examples of these so-called people. Law of jungle. Law of jungle. طبعا that's not the Muslim. المسلم النبي أعظم صلى الله عليه وسلم said, المسلم من سلم المسلمون من سلم الناس من لسانه ويده. The Muslim, الحديث صحيح, النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم says, is he or she who people are safe from two, his tongue and his hand. So now you know, you can distinguish the munafiq from the ayahs of the munafiq versus the one who is following the Nabi A'adham sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And let's go beyond the labels. Yeah. You see, because Islam sees, so that's the external, let's go now. This is the internal values. The external values is the law. Islam also provided the law. There's a law. Those who steal, there's a punishment. Those who cheat, there's a punishment, etc. There's punishment for things. Criminal justice system in Islam. Like, also the laws that people work. Always, you have to back up the morality with legal enforcement and law enforcement. Because sometimes morality is not enough. And also, I don't want people to think that law enforcement is enough. You have to treat people at home from their beginning. When they are born, you feed them to be moral, and you feed them to be straight, and you feed them to be ethical, and you feed them to be honest, and you feed them to be decent. You feed your children and your family these things just like you feed them breast milk. This is Islam. And also there's a backup, there's a legal system that then backs up the morality in Islam. Because if this thing falls, what will happen is life becomes a jungle. Literally jungle. Yani what does it mean, the jungle? Jungle means where the strong eats the weak. The rich subjugates the poor. Slavery is revived in many different forms. I'm not saying the shackles necessarily with the chains, but it could be the shackles on the mind and the shackles on all kinds of things. So here, There's an event, I may have told you that before, but it's okay to tell you. In the jungle, the lion, the fox, and the coyote, Ibn Awa, they got together, living in the jungle. Of course, the lion is the king of the jungle. The fox, you know how foxes are. They see things, they cunning, supposedly. And then you have a coyote, Ibn Awa, compared to the lion and the fox, but he's part of the deal. They go hunting. The narrator said they went hunting. The lion hunted the cow. The fox hunted the sheep, and the coyote hunted a chicken. Everyone gets on his level. At the end of the day, they sat together. Oh, they are in the jungle, sat together. And the lion said, before we start eating, I want suggestions from you. Since I'm the king, you are my people, my subjects. So I'm going to ask suggestions. So he asked Ibn Awa, he asked the coyote, he says, what do you think, how should we divide the food? I got a cow, and the fox got a sheep, and you got a chicken. How should we divide the food among us? The coyote said, dear king, this is very simple, very easy, divided itself. You got the cow, you're the king, you take the cow. Cow is the biggest. And then the fox got the chicken, got the sheep, he takes the sheep, and I take the chicken. The king looked at him, turned his hand with his sharp nails, and he chopped off the head of the coyote. Separated the head from the body. And the head was lying down. He turned to the fox. He says, dear fox, how do you think we should divide this? Yeah, now we have me and you. Now we have a cow, we have a sheep, and we have a chicken. How should we divide that? He says, okay, solve itself. It's very simple. He says, how come? He says, in the morning you have the cow, and in lunch you have the sheep, and at night you snack with the chicken. The king says, Ajib, how did you learn this to be so just and so intelligent? Qisma Ajiba, this is amazing understanding. How did you learn to be so just and so intellectually inclined? He says, what taught me is the head of the coyote. Then life becomes a jungle in all meanings, where people do not observe anything. Justice becomes injustice, and vice versa. What is just becomes unjust. Decency becomes indecency, and indecency becomes decency. The truth becomes untruth, and untruth becomes truth. When Nabi A'lam sallallahu alayhi wa sallam mentioned this, يُخَوَّنُ الْأَمِينُ وَيُتَمَنُ الْخَائِنُ حَدِيثٌ. At a time where the one who's Amin, who's trustworthy, people will accuse them of being not trustworthy. Or to the people, they will be not trustworthy. Wal Khain, the one who betrays all the time and the one who does all these things, then wants to appear in the sifa of the trustworthy. Notice the time changes. And the reason for that is people who stay away from the codes that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala told us to follow. When Nabi A'lam sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. As if we want to build this society, that is, let's say we're not talking about the Plato and the Republic and his ideal city and his ideal place, but we're talking about a realistic example, the life of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, the Khulafa al-Rashidin, and you see how things work. And how people observe. We do not claim that mistakes were not made, but we claim that there was a system of accountability and responsibility that's enforced. إِنَّا لَنَنصُرُ رُسُلَنَا وَالَّذِينَ آمَنُوا فِي الْحَيَاةِ الدُّنْيَا وَيَوْمَ يَقُومُ الْأَشْهَادِ. The ayah, as if the ayah wants to give consolation to people. إِنَّا لَنَنصُرُ, we will give victory to our messengers and those who believe. As if it's doubtful in some people's mind. يعني Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, لَنَنصُرُ الرُّسُلَ, we will give victory, we shall give victory. The meaning of the ayah. As if it's doubtful in some people's minds that the messengers of Allah and those who believe will end up being the victors, not the victims. But then this doubt, let's see where does this doubt come from. This doubt comes from what they see with their own lives. What they see with their own eyes. For example, Anbiya, yani there's hadith fi da'af, lakin la bas, yani from the point of simply going through the number, that the Anbiya are 123,000, 124,000. Sahih? 124,000 Anbiya, Prophets alayhi wasalam, were sent. That hadith rawi by Habib and others. Though there's some weakness, but the point is that massive number of Anbiya, massive number of messengers were sent. What was the destiny of most of them? That they all have a happy ending and they passed away in their sleep? Most of them were slaughtered, killed, hung. Many of them were actually, or all of them were persecuted from the beginning of the inception of their da'wah almost till the very last day of their lives. Almost all of them. You look at the seerah of the Anbiya alayhi salam. Take from all the way from Habil and Qabil, the sons of Nuh alayhi salam, through Idris, through Nuh. Nuh is making the ship and people start making fun of him. You're making the ship now. You've been here, they're making da'wah 900 some years, and all of a sudden now you change your career from a da'i to Allah to a carpenter, shipbuilder. Doesn't make any sense. Sahih? Then they say, if you want to build a ship, why don't you build a ship in the close to the ocean or close to the river? You're building it in the middle. لا يفقهون. People that Allah mentions in the Surah Al-Ahzab about these people, they don't understand. They don't see what's behind this. They only see where their eyes take them. Isa alayhi salam, from the beginning of his da'wah, as you all know, 30 years. According to most of the narration, and you know, that path of sorrow that people talk about was a daily basis for Isa alayhi salam. Every day. And before him, his mother, Maryam bint Imran. But Musa alayhi salam, you all know the torments. Moses, went to Pharaoh in Egypt, all the way to in the desert of Sinai, all the way in Al-Qudus, etc. All these things where he's talking to people, etc., etc., etc. And you see how many things and how many difficulties he had to go through. وَخِتَامُهَا النَّبِيُّ الْأَعْظَمُ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمُ From the day he was sent or he announced his message until the day صلى الله عليه وسلم he passed away to the next world, he was being tested with all these things. As if Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is telling us in this ayah here, إِنَّا لَنَنْصُرُ رُسُولَنَا. Though you may see that Yahya alayhi salam was beheaded and his head was given to a woman from Bani Israel. Ra'asaqit from Bani Israel. They gave the head of a Nabiullah, Yahya. Nabi, as a gift to a working woman from Bani Israel. The woman who does indecencies. This is the kind. But do not have a doubt. That إِنَّا لَنَنْصُرُ رُسُولَنَا وَالَّذِينَ آمَنُوا. These people, even though you see the head of Yahya on that tray, but do not think that Yahya was lost or Yahya was a victim. Yahya alayhi salam is in fact a victor. The ayah has tafsir, though it's small, but it has tafsir. Number one tafsir, Allah says, إِنَّا لَنَنْصُرُ رُسُولَنَا. We will give victory to our messengers. Not only to our messengers. What happened to those who believe? What happened to those who believe around the messengers? There's always a few, huh? There's always a few. If قال حواريون, حواريون around Isa alayhi salam, few of them, many people say there were 12, many people say there were 17, but regardless what the number is, 17 even, how many? Isa alayhi salam and his message, 17 people around him? Few people then around those messengers, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, even if it was one, Allah says, He would ensure also that they are victors. وَالَّذِينَ آمَنُوا. But في الحياة الدنيا, yes, في الحياة الدنيا, in this life, and في الآخرة. في الحياة الدنيا, it could be physical. Physical in what sense? في بدر, you all know في بدر what happened. في بدر, 313 people, let's say 300 some people, and there were thousands of people almost on the other side. And the victory from Allah came physically in the sense of what? Malaika. Literally, physically, Malaika are fighting an army of Malaika. 5,000 Malaika. Murtifin, one after the other, etc. Literally, Sahaba fighting, and among them, Malaika Allah, Malaika Rahman, Junudullah, subhanahu wa ta'ala. Notice? This is something they have seen, and they have lived with. لا, sometimes the victory could be معنوي, metaphorical. What is that? What's the biggest metaphorical, among the biggest metaphorical victories? صلح حديبيه. The Accord of Hudaybiyah. The Accord of Hudaybiyah, many people, they, what do you mean this is a victory? صلح حديبيه, where people, you all know, we don't want to go into details. If someone comes from the mushrikeen to the Muslims and he becoming Muslim, no, he's returned. If someone of the Muslims becomes mushrik and leaves, then he is left, etc. So many things that sometimes you look and you say, what kind of agreement is this? What kind of accord is this? But Al-Quran, look at Al-Quran describes it. Inna fatahna laka fathan mubina. We have opened for you. We have given you the greatest victory. To the Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. With this accord, notice. Though on the apparent side it may seem that the Muslims have lost or the believers have lost, but in the real aspect and in the real scale, no. It actually is a great victory. You see, because there is a point here to be made. And the point is, the victory is to what? To what? The victory in the dunya, the life, the message of the messengers is what? Is it about an individual? Or is it about the ideas? An individual dies. People kill individuals all the time. But the ideas do not die. And therefore, the messengers, alayhi wasalam, they came and they gave those ideas. They put blood in that lifeline of the ethics and of the morality and justice and equality and worshipping the Creator, subhanahu wa ta'ala, and that message cannot die. The point is, where do we stay? On which side? Aqir al-naqa? Even that camel. Allah said, Allah ordered them not to slaughter the camel. Slaughter the camel. Now, there's no other camels. This is no. You see how people are. Ashqaha, Al Quran mentions about them, or Hadith. You see the people, for example, that Habibul Najjar, people of Mu'min and Yasin. Qariya, one village. Allah sends to that village what? People, messengers. فَأَرْسَلْنَا إِلَيْهِمْ اثْنَيْنِ. Sent them two messengers. فَكَذَّبُوهُمَا. They belied those messengers. One city, two messengers. Not belied. How did they belie them? You know what? What is the tactic of the kuffar وَالْعَيَادُ وَالْمُنَافِقِينَ in belying the people of truth? The Quran puts it very simple. وَكَذَلِكَ جَعَلْنَا لِكُلِّ نَبِيٍّ عَدُوًا. For every prophet and those who follow the prophets, Allah says, جَعَلْنَا لَهُمْ عَدُوًا. We have made for them an enemy or enemies. Who are those enemies? شَيَاطِينَ الْإِنْسِ وَالْجِنِ. The Quran says, not shaitan, shayateen. But notice, shayateen. But where's what kind of shayateen? Al-jinn? La. Allah puts al-ins before al-jinn. Says, shayateen al-insi wal-jinn. Shayateen of the humans and the shayateen of the jinn. But prioritizes the ins before the jinn here. Notice, the human shayateen before the jinn shayateen. As if the human shayateen, that's their job to counterpart the messengers of Allah and their followers and the awliya of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That's why look what they did to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. First, sha'ir. Because he's eloquent in his speech. So they called him sha'ir. Allah defends him. وَمَا هُوَ بِقَوْلِ شَاعِر. For the Quran. It is not the saint of a sha'ir. Not only that, Allah says, وَمَا عَلَّمْنَاهُ الشِّعْرَ وَمَا يَنْبَغِي لَهُ إِنْ هُوَ إِلَّا ذِكْرٌ وَقُرْآنٌ مُبِينٌ. This is a dhikr and Qur'an mubin. You say whatever you want. La. They say sahir. That sha'ir did not work. The Qur'an answered them. Sahir. They say he's a magician. Allah says, وَمَا هُوَ بِقَوْلِ سَاحِر. This is not sahir. يقول ذلك إن تتبعون إلا رجلا مسحورا. The people, those who kuffar, they say, you follow the magician. لا, not sahir. Then they said, well, is that sahir? How about? Then when they realized they can, they said, how about one day for us, one day for you? They came to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, Husayn and others. He said, how about, you know, you rule one day, and we rule the other day. We split it this way. You see how the people of شياطين الجن الإنس والجن they go through their steps in counterparting the people of حق. يوحي بعضهم إلى بعض زخرف القول غرورا. The mechanism is what? One shaitan tells the other shaitan زخرف القول, sayings that are beautified, but these things are really false and empty. Allah says ذرهم وما يفترون. Abandon them and abandon the iftira or the lies they make. This is their ways. But what is the ways of the people of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? Mu'min al-Fir'aun. Afwan, Mu'min al-Surat Yasin. The man comes, messengers go to that village, two of them, they say, believe in Allah. Believe in the creator that created you. No, we don't. فَعَزَّزْنَا بِثَالِثِ. Allah sent a third messenger to the same city, three people, same village, three messengers. قَالُوا إِلَيْكُمْ وَرْسَلُونَ. What is your job? We are messengers, we are sent to you. The people of the village, قَالُوا مَا أَنْتُمْ إِلَّا بَشَرٌ مِثْلُنَا وَمَا أَنْزَلَ الرَّحْمَنُ مِنْ شَيْءٍ إِنْ أَنْتُمْ لَتَكْذِبُونَ. You are just human beings like us. You are simply liars. You are making this up. The messengers kept. Until the people gathered around these messengers, the people of the village gathered around them, they wanted to kill them. And you notice how people go to extreme violence simply for the idea. These messengers are coming to tell you, giving you an idea. Believe in Allah, the one who is worthy of being worshipped, etc., etc., all these things. No. They want to kill them because you see, the voice of truth makes the people of ظلم and tyranny unable to sleep. يقض مضاجع الظالمين حقيقة. See people of truth. حتى أبو جهل when he was asleep he could not sleep because the Nabi صلى الله عليه وسلم was still alive. So much that when he was killed في بدر, when they killed him, he brought عبد الله بن مسعود. عبد الله بن مسعود was there. He says يا عبد الله بن مسعود, from أبو جهل, tell أبلغ محمدا. Look at this. He's dying. أبلغ محمدا, tell محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم that I am his enemy dead and alive. أن يعدوه حي وميتا. And I, he's killing me, but I am his enemy. Nabi صلى الله عليه وسلم was told this, and he says, Allahu Akbar. إِنَّ فِرْعَوْنِي, my Fir'aun is worse than the Fir'aun of Musa. Because the Fir'aun of Musa, when death came close to him and he was almost drowning in the water, he says, أَمَنْتُ بِالَّذِي أَمَتْ بِي بَنُوا إِسْرَائِيلِ. I believe in he who Banu Israel believe in. I believe in him. But my Fir'aun, Abu Jahl, even at the time of death refused. Look at the hatred in some people's hearts. Look at the hatred. Even then, he refused and he says, I am his enemy, dead and alive. صلى الله وسلم وبارك على هذا النبي وعلى آله أهل الفقه والنظر والعلم والأثر وعلم بآثار تفرقت. إننا ننصر رسلنا. We will give support to our messengers and those who believe in this dunya. ويوم يقوم الأشهاد. And the day where witnesses are called. You know why Allah says, not يوم القيامة, says the day witnesses are called? Because now the witnesses are silenced. But in the day of judgment, the witnesses are not silenced anymore. They will be able to speak. يَوْمَ تَشْهَدُ أَيْدِيهِمْ wa. Their hands will witness. And their feet will witness. And everything will witness, will come and will be called as a witness to Allah Rabbul Alameen. This is what this person did. And this is what this person did. And this is how this person lied. And this is how this person cheated. And this is what, etc., 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 etc. يوم تقوم الأشهاد. That day, the victory will also be to the awliya of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and to the anbiya of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The question for us is, Habib al-Najjar, his entire village were against the three messengers and he took a sole stand. One day when he came and he saw them, that they're trying to kill them, he says, why are you trying to kill these people and what are they telling you to worship? the mere idea. Why is there that violence? Notice that the Quran stresses on the anti or non-violence methods. And the whole Prophet ﷺ, the Prophet did not come with violence. You don't see any Prophet that came with nuclear weapons, do you? From Adam ﷺ, that can Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he could give whatever they want of weapons. But you see, the only weapon that the Anbiya came with is the weapon of hikmah, and the weapon of logic, and the weapon of the book of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and the weapon of mercy. That's the weapon they came with. Therefore, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said about the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, وَمَا أَرْسَلْنَاكَ إِلَّا رَحْمَةً لِلْعَالَمِينَ. But the people of Habib Najjar, they wanted to kill those messengers. They told him, you are also with them? You are also, are you trying to defend them? Are you one of them? قَالَ مَالِيَا. Why shouldn't I worship the one that you don't, that you يعني شفاعة شيء ولا يقدر. إني إذا لفي ضلال مبين. If I do not worship their creator, I am seriously then indeed misguided. Then they wanted to kill him as well with the messengers. They put the knife on his face, on his neck. He says, and then he made a declaration. إني آمنت بربكم فاسمعون. I am a believer in your Lord, so everyone hear me. He wanted to make the witness now certified before he dies. And then they killed him. قِيلَ ادْخُلِ الْجَنَّةِ. When they killed him and the blood was coming out of his neck, the malaika came and Allah ordered them, enter Jannah. قِيلَ ادْخُلِ الْجَنَّةِ. As you all know, when people die, they see their space, their place in Jannah. وَالْعِيَادُ بِاللَّهِ or they're in other places, huh? He saw his place in Jannah. قِيلَ دُخُلِ الْجَنَّةِ. What did he say? قَالَ يَا لَيْتَ قَوْمِي يَعْلَمُونَ بِمَا غَفَرَ لِي رَبِّي وَجَعَلَنِي مُكَرِّمًا. I wish that I can go back to show my people what I am seeing from Jannah in front of me so they can believe. I wish I can go back and just show them what I am seeing so they can also have what I have. Life is about a principle. Today we're here, tomorrow we're gone. Where do we stand in the principles? I'll finish with this. Al-Imam al-Husayn ibn Ali and Wafat ibn Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was leaving Al-Hijaj to Iraq. Al-Farazdaq sees him on the way. Al-Farazdaq is a poet. He sees him on the way. Al-Farazdaq is going to Al-Hijaj, and Al-Husayn is going to Iraq, to Nineveh, to Karbala. Al-Farazdaq tells Al-Husayn, he says, Ya ibn Rasulullah, O son of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, قلوب الناس معك وسيوفهم عليك. The famous saying. He says, the hearts of people in Iraq are with you. Imam Husayn says, how did you leave the people in Iraq behind you, Ya Farazdaq? He says, Ya ibn Rasulullah, I have left them with their hearts with you and swords against you. Some people are what? Their hearts are with you, but their swords are against you. So he's telling them, if you go, you will die. And Imam Husayn, he says, Sadaqt, you are saying the truth. لِلَّهِ الْأَمْرُ مِنْ قَبْلُ وَمِنْ بَعْدُ. To Allah belongs everything, from before and from after. وَاللَّهِ لَا يَهْدَمْ. By Allah, he does not care who. مَنْ كَانَتْ لِلْحَقِّ غَايَتُهُ وَفِي التَّقْوَى سَرِيرَتُهُ. Who? He will not care who Allah is his objective, and taqwa is his secrecy. His inside is filled with taqwa. Because what? Allah will take all this earth with everything that's on it. Today you're here, tomorrow you're gone. And everything is counted. No one will outlive. Everyone, just thousands and millions before, have left. And so will we. But the stand that you take will count. And stand that you will take will make you either on this side or on that side. فَلَوْ خَلَدَ الْكِرَامِ إِذَنْ خَلَدْنَا وَلَوْ بَقِيَ الْمُلُوكُ إِذَنْ بَقِينَا. If the muluk, if the kings had stayed, we will also stay. But no one will stay. And Allah deemed this earth to perish because to Him belongs the dominion. I ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to make us realize that if we stay with the messengers and those who believe in the messengers, you will be a victor regardless of what people consider you, whether you're a victim or others. And you will have victory in this life, and you will have victory in the hereafter when the witnesses are called. Allahumma salli ala Sayyidina.
Inna alhamdulillahi na'maduhu wa nasta'inu wa nasta'firuh ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا. من يهد الله فلا مضل له، ومن يضلل فلا هادي له. ونشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له، ونشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله. يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله حق تقاته ولا تموتن إلا وأنتم مسلمون. يا أيها الناس اتقوا ربكم الذي خلقكم من نفس واحدة وخلق منها زوجها وبث منهما رجالا كثيرا ونساء، واتقوا الله الذي تساءلون به والأرحام، إن الله كان عليكم رقيبا. يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله وقولوا قولا سديدا يصلح لكم أعمالكم ويغفر لكم ذنوبكم، ومن يطع الله ورسوله فقد فاز فوزا عظيما. فإن أصدق الحديث كتاب الله، وخير الهدي هدي محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم، وشر الأمور محدثاتها، وكل محدثة بدعة، وكل بدعة ضلالة، وكل ضلالة في النار. Verily, all praise is due to Allah. We praise Him, seek His help, and ask for His forgiveness. We seek refuge in Allah from the evil of our own souls and from our sinful deeds. Whoever Allah guides, no one can mislead, and whomever Allah allows to stray, no one can guide. I bear witness that there is none worthy of worship except Allah, having no partners. And I bear witness that Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is his servant and his messenger. O believers, have fear of Allah according to his rights and die not except in the state of Islam. O mankind, have fear of your Lord, the one who created you from one soul and created from its mate, and from them spread many men and women. And fear Allah, from whom you demand your mutual rights, and do not cut off the ties of kinship. Surely Allah is ever and all watcher over you. O believers, have fear of Allah and always speak the truth. He will direct you to righteous deed and will forgive you your sins. And whosoever obeys Allah and His Messenger has indeed achieved a great achievement. Is the book of Allah, the best guidance is the guidance of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. The innovated ones, every innovated matter is a heresy. And every heresy is a misguidance, and every misguidance is in the fire of hell. يقول الله تعالى في القرآن الكريم بعد أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم وإذ قال ربك للملائكة إني جاعل في الأرض خليفة قالوا أتجعل فيها من يفسد فيها ويسفك الدماء ونحن نسبح بحمدك ونقدس لك قال إني أعلم ما لا تعلمون وعلم آدم الأسماء كلها ثم عرضهم على الملائكة فقال أنبئوني بأسماء هؤلاء إن كنتم صادقين قالوا سبحانك لا علم لنا إلا ما علمتنا إنك أنت العليم الحكيم قال يا آدم أنبئهم بأسمائهم فلما أنبأهم بأسمائهم قال ألم أقل لكم إني أعلم غيب السماوات والأرض وأعلم ما تبدون وما كنتم تكتمون وإذ قلنا للملائكة اسجدوا لآدم فسجدوا إلا إبليس أبى واستكبر وكان من الكافرين وقلنا يا آدم اسكن أنت وزوجك الجنة وكلا منها رغدا حيث شئتما ولا تقربا هذه الشجرة فتكونا من الظالمين فأذلهما الشيطان عنها فأخرجهما مما كان فيه وكل احبطوا بعضكم لبعض عدو ولكم في الأرض مستقر ومتاع إلى حين فتلقى آدم من ربه كلمات فتاب عليه إنه هو التواب الرحيم قلنا احبطوا منها جميعا فإما يأتينكم مني هدى فمن تبع هداي فلا خوف عليهم ولا هم يحزنون والذين كفروا وكذبوا بآياتنا أولئك أصحاب النار هم فيها خالدون صدق الله العظيم. My dear respected brothers and sisters in Islam, I recite a few verses from Surah Al-Baqarah, verse number 30 to 39. These 10 verses describe a story for us to learn some lessons from, and inshallah, maybe when I share the meanings, the lessons will become more clearer, and hopefully we will understand as to where we go as human beings of Allah's creation and what is our objective in this life. In ayah number 30, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَإِسْقَالَ رَبُّكَ لِلْمَلَائِكَةِ إِنِّي جَعَلٌ فِي الْأَرْضِ خَلِيفَةً. And when Allah said to the angels, I'm about to place a viceroy, a khalifa, in the earth, the angels responded, قَالُوا أَتَجَلُ فِيهَا مَنْ يُفْسِدُ فِيهَا وَيُسْفِكُ الدِّمَاءَ وَنَحْنُ نُسَبِّحُ بِحَمْدِكَ وَنُقَدِّسُ لَكَ. They said, will you place on earth a one who will do harm therein and will shed blood? While we, the angels, we hymn your praise and we sanctify you. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala responded, قَالَ إِنِّي عَلَمُ مَا لَا تَعْلَمُ. He said, surely I know that which you do not. So first, very important lesson for us human beings is to understand Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is al-Ghayb. Allah has all the knowledge. We have very limited knowledge according to what Allah has provided us to think from our minds and see from what we see. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala responded to the angels that even though if you look at today's condition where we are, what we are doing, what the humanity is going through, what angels saw and what they said was not wrong. Human beings today are creating the facade on the face of the earth, shedding blood day in and day out. But Allah responded that you do not know what I know. Because Allah, in the next ayah, as He says, وَعَلَّمَ آدَمَ الْأَسْمَاءَ كُلَّهَا ثُمَّ عَرَضَهُمْ عَلَى الْمَلَائِكَةِ فَقَالَ أَنْبِئُونِي بِأَسْمَاءِ هَؤُلَاءِ إِن كُنْتُمْ صَادِقِينَ. And Allah taught Adam all the names, then showed them to the angels and saying, inform me of the names of these if you are truthful. The challenge came from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that now the knowledge that Allah has provided Adam alayhi salam, which of course continues on today to every single human being that is born on the face of the earth, that knowledge is blessed to that human being by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And Allah is saying that, do you have the knowledge of these things? If you do, say it. And very humbly, the angels submitted, قَالُوا سُبْحَانَكَ لَا عِلْمَ لَنَا إِلَّا مَا عَلَّمْتَنَا إِنَّكَ أَنْتَ الْعَلِيمُ الْحَكِيمُ. They said, be glorified, we have no knowledge except that which you have taught us. You only are the knower, the wise. First thing that in this ayah number 30 that we understood, Ta'ala, when Allah decided to put the human beings on the face of the earth, the Quran is very clear on this matter for us to understand that the creation is from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It did not just happen in vain. It did not just happen by any big bang. It did not happen over the process of evolution. It did not happen any other way except Allah decided to create this creation on the face of the earth. And that's why we are here today. Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala put us on the face of the earth. And in another place, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has said that Allah has not created وَمَا خَلَقْتَ الْجِنَّ وَالْإِنسَ إِلَّا لِيَعْبُدُونَ. The jinn and insa are not created except for one reason, that they be the subservient servants to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. They be submissive servants to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. They give up what they think is right in place of what they know that what Allah has said is correct and true. Allah gave that knowledge to human beings to understand what is right and what is wrong. On this day, if you went to any human being, worst of the kinds or the best of the kinds, they will be able to, if they are truthful to you, they will be able to tell you what is right and what is wrong. No human being will tell you that usurping somebody else's right is correct. Hurting somebody else is correct. Doing things wrongfully to somebody is correct. Nobody says that. Allah has given by nature that knowledge to us to know what is right and what is wrong. For us to be able to say that Allah's provided knowledge is incorrect is haram for us to do. Allah has provided the best of the knowledge that there is. Allah created this human being to come on the face of the earth to be submissive and knowing, as the angels said to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that this will be the one who will create the fasad. This will be the one who will shed blood. Allah said, I know what you don't know. Because as we know that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave us this understanding, not just to do the right thing, but do the right things according to the commands of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. As many of us choose to do that, many of us decide not to do that. It's the choice that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has provided for us, and many of us decide to go against that command of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. When Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala provided that knowledge to Adam alayhi salam, He put that challenge back to the malaika. Do you know this? If not, if you do, then say it. If not, then be understanding that I am the one who knows it, and I am creating this human being, this creation of mine, for a special purpose, for a special plan, that the human being comes on the earth so that we may live through this. Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has said earlier that we have been created to be nothing but an abd of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, a servant of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, a slave of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, committing ourselves to be submissive to Allah and Allah's will only. My dear brothers and sisters, this is something very important for us to remember at all times, because those of us who start to feel that they are more powerful and now they are something and they can do this or they can do this, and we start to think that we become a superpower, we become a superhuman being, we become this, we become that, we forget that Allah the Almighty is the supreme of the powers. Allah the Almighty is in control of all that is with us, around us. In the past few months that we've been going, especially in this part of the world, there is being a constant reminder to conserve water, that we are in a state of drought. And we need to do whatever we can to use the least amount that we can, so we can conserve and it will last us longer. First of all, as a Muslim, we shouldn't have had this problem anyways. We should already be using it in the most moderate ways. As we know, the Rasulullah said that be conservative with the water, even if you are by the flowing river. So, no matter what abundance that you may have of water, you conserve it. So as a Muslim, as a believer, we must be doing that to begin with. If we are not, we must start right now to understand that we should not be those who waste any of the bounties of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that is provided to us. And the second thing came to mind was there was a planning going on that we need to do this, we need to do this. But did not see in discussion that what if Allah does not bring this rain down? Well, you know, we'll borrow water from this place. Well, what if this rain stops over there as well? Well, we'll borrow it from next place. Well, what if it stops over there as well? Are we thinking that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is not Qadir, that He can take the water away from us, dry the rivers? The most important lesson is to understand that we as human beings are limited in our capacities, limited in our thinking, limited in our efforts. If we did not seek and turn back to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, we would be shamed in this world and shamed in the hereafter. And may Allah protect us from being shamed in the hereafter. My dear brothers and sisters, inshallah, just as a side note, because this is Surah Al-Baqarah, a few ayahs, the early ayahs of Surah Al-Baqarah, and it may help us to also think that what is our relationship with Qur'an. Alhamdulillah, we have so many hafaz amongst us, and Allah has blessed them with the Qur'an in their hearts. So that's the greatest blessing that these brothers and sisters would have. But what about the rest of us who are not blessed with the memorization of the Qur'an yet? Who are not blessed with understanding of the Qur'an yet? What are we doing to change that condition? Isn't that one of the parts of living by the commandments of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? Isn't Qur'an something that we should have that relationship with? There is the hadith of Prophet ﷺ regarding Surah Al-Baqarah that this is one of the surahs that will provide the shade to the believer on the Day of Judgment, when there will be no other shade. This surah could provide us with the shade. If this surah is in our hearts, hopefully inshallah, not just the words of the Qur'an, but actually also in the understanding of the surah and in the practice of this surah as well. And if it is in our hearts, Allah may make this Qur'an, this one surah for us, as a shade on Yawm al-Qiyamah. On the day there will be no shade. On the day the sun will be at a distance that is unimaginable. My dear brothers and sisters, I think it's really important for us to pay attention to the Qur'an as well. We do pay attention to everything else. Alhamdulillah, our jobs, our school, our home, we do pay attention. Alhamdulillah, that's something we must do. But let's not neglect the Qur'an and not bring it into our lives as well. Maybe inshallah, Ramadan has just gone a little over 2 months ago. Maybe we can revitalize ourselves and maybe start memorizing Surah Al-Baqarah. If not, maybe some short surahs in the back. But we start that process, and we start that process to continue that, and Allah knows best, in maybe 2 years, 3 years, 10 years, 5 years down the road, we may be amongst the Hufaz as well. And if we die in the process and we have not memorized the Qur'an, Allah knows best, we may be raised up in the Hufaz because we have the niyyah to memorize the Qur'an and to put the Qur'an in our hearts. And hopefully, inshallah, into our actions also. Aqulu qawli hadha, astaghfirullah wa atubu ilayhi. Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa ala ali Muhammad. كما صليت على ابراهيم وعلى ال ابراهيم في العالمين انك حميد مجيد. اللهم بارك على محمد وعلى ال محمد كما باركت على ابراهيم وعلى ال ابراهيم في العالمين انك حميد مجيد. In the next ayah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, قال يا ادم انبئهم باسمائهم فلما انبئهم باسمائهم قال الم اقل لكم اني اعلم غيب السماوات والارض وَعَلَمُ مَا تُبْدُونَ وَمَا كُنْتُمْ تَبْتُمُونَ. Allah said, O Adam, inform them of their names. And when He had informed them of their names, Allah said, did I not tell you that I know the secret of the heavens and the earth, and I know that which you disclose and which you hide. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala asked Adam to repeat the names, the knowledge that was provided by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Adam, when he said it, and Allah says, "Good of your religion, I not tell you that I know the secrets of the heavens and the earth. I know what you disclose and what you hide." This is, Allah has that knowledge that what we may not know about each other, but Allah knows about it. وَإِذْ قُلْنَا لِلْمَلَائِكَةِ اسْجُدُوا لِآدَمَ فَسَجَدُوا إِلَّا إِبْلِيسَ أَبَى وَاسْتَكْبَرَ وَكَانَ مِنَ الْكَافِرِينَ. And when we said unto the angel, "Prostrate yourself before Adam," they fell prostrate, all except Iblis. He demurred through pride and so became a disbeliever. My dear brothers, we know this story, we've heard this story so many times. It's been reminded over and over again that when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala commanded the malaika to bow down, to make sajda to Adam alayhi salam, they all did except Iblis. He was amongst the kafirin. My dear brothers and sisters, this lesson is not just a story that Allah tells us in the Quran, and we listen to Him, listen to it, and we just walk away. How many of us today refuse to make sajda to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala on a regular basis 5 times a day? How many of us ignore that sajda to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala on regularly every day? How many of us can stand up and say in front of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that I try to make 5 salah in the day? How many of us are going to be able to say, you know, that when I'm at work, that I really cannot make it and I miss it, and then when I come home and do it? And sometimes I don't even do that. Sometimes it's too late and I'm sitting at the gathering and I'm at the dinner and people are talking. I just didn't want to make Isha at that time and it was too late and then I was too tired and I went to sleep without Isha. How many of us today are not in the masjid even on Yom al-Jum'ah? The best of the days, best of the times. Do we not see that Shaitan is working on us? Did he not make this promise to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that I will continue to misguide those who will not follow your commands? Do we not see amongst ourselves, our own brothers and sisters, who tend to stray away from making sajda to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? How conscious are we of the salah 5 times a day? And this is a reminder to myself, brother. This is not a finger pointing to anyone. It's first thing to myself and to anybody else. We all must look at ourselves. Alhamdulillah, we belong to Allah's deen where there is no confession to anybody. We make confession to ourselves. We find what are our shortcomings. If we are neglecting our salah, if we are neglecting those 5 daily salah, then we must take actions to do something about that salah. If we think it is okay for me to miss the salah just because I'm at work, we must reconsider that thought. We must consult scholars if we are not convinced that salah should be performed on time, because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has commanded that in the Quran, in the Surah Al-Mu'mineena Kitab al-Maqud, that those prescribed prayers are enjoined upon the believer that are performed on time. They're prescribed times. I know this is a time when the days are short, so most of our salat are happening during our working hours. It's a bigger challenge, bigger test, that we must give up whatever we are doing, take that 5 minutes break, stop, and come to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and submit ourselves, and let not Shaitan, Iblis, take us along with him towards the fire of hell. May Allah protect us all from that fire of hell. Allah promises that he is amongst those who is going towards fire of hell. And if any one of us follows him, we may now end up in that fire of hell as well. وَقُلْنَا يَا آدَمُ اسْكُنْ أَنْتَ وَزَوْجُكَ الْجَنَّةَ وَكُلَا مِنْهَا رَغَدًا حَيْثُ شِئْتُمَا وَلَا تَقْرَبَا هَذِهِ الشَّجَرَةَ فَتَكُونَا مِنَ الظَّالِمِينَ. And he said, O Adam, dwell thou and thy wife in the garden, and eat freely of the fruits thereof where you are, but come not near this tree. And if you do so, you will become wrongdoers. فَأَذَلَّهُمَا الشَّيْطَانُ عَنْهَا فَأَخْرَجَهُمَا مِمَّا كَانَ فِيهِ وَكُلْنَا اهْبِطُوا بَعْضُكُمْ لِبَعْضٍ عَدُوٌّ وَلَكُمْ فِي الْأَرْضِ مُسْتَقَرٌّ وَمَتَاعٌ إِلَى حِينٍ. But Shaitan caused them to deflect there from and expel them from the happy state in which they were. And Allah said, fall down one of you, a foe unto the other. There shall be for you on earth a habitation and provision for a time. فَتَلَقَّى آدَمُ مِنْ رَبِّهِ كَلِمَاتٍ فَتَابَ عَلَيْهِ إِنَّهُ هُوَ التَّوَّابُ الرَّحِيمُ. Then Adam received from his Lord the words of revelation and he repented towards him. Allah is the one who accepts repentance, the most merciful. قُلْ لَهْبِتُ مِنْهَا جَمِيعًا فَإِمَّا يَأْتِيَنَّكُمْ مِنِّي هُدًى فَمَنْ تَبِعَ هُدَايَ فَلَا خَوْفٌ عَلَيْهِمْ وَلَا هُمْ يَحْزَنُونَ. We say, go down all of you from here, but verily there come to you from me, Allah, a guidance. And whosoever follows my guidance, there shall no fear come upon them, neither shall they grieve. وَالَّذِينَ كَفَرُوا وَكَذَّبُوا بِآيَاتِنَا أُولَٰئِكَ أَصْحَابُ النَّارِ هُمْ فِيهَا خَالِدُونَ. But they who disbelieve and deny our revelations, such are rightful owners of the fire. They will abide therein. My dear brothers and sisters, the most important thing is that every one of us can and do make mistakes. Just like our father Adam alayhi salam did. But the beauty of this deen that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala guided him to seek tawbah. And he was able to seek that tawbah. And seek Allah's forgiveness and repented to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and went in the direction which was pleasing to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That is the most important lesson that we must remember and remind ourselves and remind our children, that when we do make mistakes, does not mean that we just continue to go on in that direction, continue to make that mistake, but we stop. If I'm being neglectful in my salah, I still have time. Right now, today, I have the time. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has blessed me that I'm still breathing. I'm able to talk. I'm able to walk. I have an opportunity to make sure that my salah from Asr is not being neglected. I'm not just letting it go and wait until the last minute before Maghrib. I may get, you know, just barely get home to make my salah. I'm just getting in that I finish my Asr Salah and Maghrib is already there and I make my Maghrib. That is being neglectful to our Salah. Take that opportunity wherever you are. Allah has made this earth a masjid for us. To not neglect the Salah. This is the time. I know when in just few days we are coming into New Year's of Gregorian calendar, and in few more days, inshallah, Hijri calendars, we are coming into New Year as well. Muharram is beginning around 8th or 9th of January. There's nothing wrong to make some resolutions for ourselves. That inshallah, in the coming year, I will try to protect my salah. I will concentrate in my salah. I will make my salah where it is, has the khushu that is required to be amongst the true servants of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It's an effort, it's the time that we will have to put through. It's the choice that we have made when we حسن أشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله. We made this choice. Alhamdulillah, every one of us, every single one of us have committed that themselves, that Allah is the only one that we must submit to, and Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is his messenger and is his servant. We have made that choice. And when we have made that choice, we must fulfill the requirements of that choice. Do we go to a job, join a new company, and make a commitment that we will do the work that is required of us, and then we go and sit and neglect that work? Do we do that? What happens when we do that? We get fired. We lose our job. We start to look at another place, and we learn that lesson that this is the job that we have made a commitment to. This is, as a human being, we have made a commitment to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that I, as a believer, will submit to your commands. And one of the most important commands is as-salah. The Rasulullah ﷺ, till the last moments of his life, was concerned about salah for his ummah. Was concerned about, are they performing their salah? Do we think that those sahabas who were around him would be neglectful of the salah? Was that message for those sahabas who were around him that they must be careful in performing their salah? Or was this message for the generations of ummah to come as a message that do not be neglectful of your salah? My dear brothers and sisters, may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala help me understand this and help us all understand this message from the Quran and the Sunnah of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and make us among those who truly enjoy their salah, who are truly careful about their salah, who are truly concerned about performing their salah on time. May Allah make us among those who have the khushu in the salah, that they feel that they are in the presence of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. If they are not seeing Allah, they know that Allah is definitely seeing them. Make us among those who are those when they perform the salah, Allah accepts their salah. Make us among those that our salahs are not like those that doesn't even rise above from the ground. Make us among those who protect their salah at all times. Make us among those who learn salah properly and teach to their children proper salah. Make us among those who are not shameful in learning the salah, even when they are older and they do not know it properly. They make effort to learn it even now because they know that this is something that they must do to become a better believer. اللهم اعذنا فيما عافنا فيما تولينا فيما باركنا فيما عافانا من شر ما تليت انك تقضي بذلك انه لا يظلم ولا يظلم عليك نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونعوذ بالله من شرور انفسنا ومن سيئات اعمالنا من يهد الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلا هادي له وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله الله حق تقاته ولا تموتن إلا وأنتم مسلمون يا أيها الناس اتقوا ربكم الذي خلقكم من نفس واحدة وخلق منها زوجها وبث منهما رجالا كثيرا ونساء واتقوا الله الذي تساءلون به والأرحام إن الله كان عليكم رقيبا يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله وقولوا قولا سديدا يصلح لكم أعمالكم ويغفر لكم ذنوبكم ومن يطع الله ورسوله فقد فاز فوزا عظيما أما بعد فإن خير الحديث كتاب الله وخير الهدي هدي محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم وشر الأمور محدثاتها وكل بدعة دلالة وكل دلالة في النار. All praises are due to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We praise Him and seek His help and ask for His forgiveness. We seek refuge in Allah from the evil in our own souls and from our own sinful deeds. Whoever Allah guides, no one can mislead, and whoever Allah lets astray, no one can guide. I bear witness that there is no one worthy of worship except Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He is one, having no partner. And I bear witness that Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is his servant and messenger. O believers, have taqwa, have God consciousness, have taqwa of Allah according to His rights, and die not except in the state of Islam. O mankind, have taqwa of your Lord, the one who created you from one soul and created from its maid, and from them spread many men and women. And fear Allah, from whom you demand your mutual right, and do not discontinue family relations. Surely Allah is ever and all watcher over you. O believers, have taqwa of Allah and always speak the truth. He will direct you to do righteous deed and will forgive you your sins. And whosoever obeys Allah and His Messenger has indeed achieved a great achievement. My dear brothers and sisters in Islam, today inshallah I want to touch base, just touch upon a personality who since his existence has been loved more than anyone ever on the face of the earth. And even since he has passed away, he has been remembered by billions and billions of us and will continue to be remembered till the Day of Judgment. And that personality, as you have already guessed probably, is of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi wa sallam. My dear brothers, we submit ourselves to the command of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. We make sure that we don't try to go and go against the sunnah of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. We make best effort to try to follow his example sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. But as you may also know, that there are people who call themselves maybe Muslims, who call themselves as a group of Quraniyuns, of group of Parwezis, or whatever they may name for themselves, but their main problem is that they believe that Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was just there to get us the message of the Quran, and that's it. And today, inshallah, just from the Quran, not even going into the details of the hadith of Rasulullah himself, but just from the Quran, few ayahs, not even many, just going to bring upon to emphasize that Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was not just there to bring the message. He was there to bring the message and show it to us what that message meant to implement in our lives. Rasulullah was an example, was chosen by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and he was best of the mankind ever existed on the face of the earth. If these people who may call themselves that Rasulullah was just there to bring the message, and really not much more than that, they really don't know what Quran talks about. They really don't know what Quran means when he talks about the importance of this one man sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi wa sallam. It is an obligation on the believers to believe in Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam as a messenger chosen by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And just in few ayahs in Surah Taghabun, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, A'udhu billahi minash shaitan rajeem, فَآمِنُوا بِاللَّهِ وَرَسُولِهِ وَنُورِ الَّذِي أَنزَلْنَا وَاللَّهُ بِمَا تَعْمَلُونَ خَبِيرٌ. So believe in Allah and His Messenger and the light which we have revealed, Al-Quran Al-Kareem. And Allah is informed of what you do.
in Surah Tawbah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, A'udhu billahi min shaitanir rajim, ذلك بأنهم كفروا بالله ورسوله والله لا يهدي القوم الفاسقين. That is because they disbelieve in Allah and His Messenger. And Allah guide not wrongdoers. In continuation in Surah Tawbah in ayah number 24, an excellent example has been given for the believers to understand the importance of following and believing in Allah and loving Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and loving Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam over all that we have. And listen to this ayah. أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم. قل إن كان آباؤكم وأبناؤكم وإخوانكم وأزواجكم وعشيرتكم وأموال اقترفتموها وتجارة تخشون كسادها ومساكن ترضونها أحب إليكم من الله ورسوله وجهاد في سبيله وتربصوا حتى يأتي الله بأمره والله لا يهدي القوم الفاسقين. And Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam is being commanded to say this to the believers. Say, if your fathers, your sons, your brethren, your wives, your tribe, and the wealth that you have acquired, and the merchandise for that, for you fear that there will be no sale, and dwellings that you desire are dearer to you than Allah and His Messenger and striving in His way, then wait till Allah brings His command to pass. Allah guide not those who are wrongdoers. Allah does not guide the fasiqoon. My dear brothers and sisters, this is an important ayah to remember, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is describing those things, those are halal. Loving your father, your children, your brothers, your wives, your tribe, your family, taking care of your property, taking care of your home, taking care of your wealth, taking care of halal risk. All that is good. Not that these are haram things, not that these are prohibited, not that these are something that will make us commit doing things that are against the command of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is comparing these halal things. If you love all this more than you love Allah and His Rasul, and jihad fi sabilillah, and striving in the path of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, then wait till Allah sends His command down to decide your fate. My dear brothers and sisters, this is something very serious to understand, that all these halal things in front of us are being put, and we are being said that if you love all these good things that are permissible for you more than Allah and His Messenger and jihad fi sabilillah, then you must be doing something wrong. Because Allah's love and the Messenger of Allah, His love, needs to be above what you seek in this world. And it is important for each and every one of us to see. Nobody has to show a mirror to anybody else. Each and every one of us can stand in front of a mirror ourselves and see as to where do I stand when it comes to loving Allah and His Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Where do I stand when it comes to follow the commands of Allah and His Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam? What is my position when it comes to my relationship with Allah and His Messenger? Where do I stand? And each man and women amongst ourselves can look at themselves to see for themselves. Nobody needs to point fingers to anybody else, but if every one of us look at ourselves, subhanAllah, we'll make a big revolution right there. The Ummah will start to correct themselves. We all will start to look at ourselves and point our own mistakes to ourselves and say, where am I going wrong? What am I doing that is incorrect according to the command of Allah and His Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and how can I try to bring myself back into the path to follow the message of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and with that regard follow the commandments of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala as well. It is not only an obligation to follow Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, it is an obligation to love Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. I said in the beginning that I will touch base from the Quranic ayahs, but of course, how can we leave the sayings of our Prophet? One of the sayings of our beloved Prophet Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is that none of you is a truly a believer until I am, meaning Rasulullah, until I am more beloved to him than his father, his son, and all people. That hadith just came in confirmation with that ayah that we just read from Surah At-Tawbah in a second ago. That all that in this world needs to become secondary to our allegiance to Allah and His Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, in our love of Allah and His Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. In Surah Hud, in Surah Azab, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala reminds the Prophet is closer to the believers than their own selves. Important thing maybe is here to look that Allah is not saying as a suggestion. It's not a idea that Rasulullah would be more closer to us than our own self. But Allah is saying that the Prophet is closer, so it must be, it should be closer to us in our following his examples. In Surah Ali Imran, Allah reminds us, قُلْ إِن كُنْتُمْ تُحِبُّونَ اللَّهِ فَاتَّبِعُونِ يُحْبِبْكُمُ اللَّهِ. Say, asking Rasulullah SAW to the mankind, if you love Allah, follow me. So Rasulullah is being asked by Allah to say that if you love Allah, follow me, follow Rasulullah. Allah will love you. So one of our criteria to be loved by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is to follow Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi wa sallam. We must support and honor Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. As Allah says in Surah Al-Fatiha, إِنَّا أَرْسَلْنَكَ شَاهِدًا وَمُبَشِّرًا وَنَذِيرًا لِتُؤْمِنُوا بِاللَّهِ وَرَسُولِهِ وَتُعَذِّرُهُ. Lo, we have sent, O Muhammad, as a witness, sent the Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam as a witness and a bearer of good tidings and a warner. He has been shahidan, mubashir, and nazira, that you, the mankind, may believe in Allah and His Messenger and may honor Him. So al-dhiruhu is honoring, giving the izzah, giving the respect that is due to our beloved Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And inshallah, in a minute, I will touch base upon that even though the Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is not amongst us today, but the respect and the honor that belongs to Rasulullah has to be taken care of even today while Rasulullah is not amongst us. In another place in Surah An-Nur, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, لا تجعلوا دعاء الرسول بينكم كدعاء بعدكم بعد. Make not the calling of the messenger among you as your calling one to another. Respect of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam even today stand as is, that even when we mention his name, he says sallallahu alaihi wasallam. We don't just mention Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam casually that we would mention each other's name or we would call each other. We would not do that to Rasulullah, even while he was alive. The believers were reminded around him that they should not call Rasulullah in the same way that they would address each other. And the best thing to remember that only a couple of places that Rasulullah in the Quran has been addressed by his name. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala give the due respect to Rasulullah by Ya Ayyuhan Nabi, Ya Ayyuhan Rasul, not even calling him by name in this way. So when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gives that respect, and in the ayah that we have seen, he encourages us and in some places commands us to give that respect to Rasulullah. So to anyone who would say that this was just the job of Rasulullah was to bring the hadith, bring the Quran, and that's it. No, Rasulullah was kind of khuluquhu al-Quran. His character was Quran. His walk was Quran. His talk was Quran. So this, his example for us is an important one that we all must try to follow, because all the salawat that we pray every day, five times a day, was shown to us by Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, how we must act when we are in front of our Rabb and our Lord and our Master. So he was not just an ordinary man. He was Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Allah has chosen him to be the best of the humankind. We don't make him to the level of Allah, na'udhu billahi min dhalik. We do not worship Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Not at all, never, ever. We worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala only and only forever. But the way of the worship has been shown to us by Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. We understand Allah better by reading the seerah of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. We see how he acted upon a different situation and how he believed in Allah and how he depended upon Allah, and we take that example to follow in our lives as well. In Surah Al-Mujadala, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, Ya ayyuhal ladzina amanu idh najaytuhumur rasulu faqaddamu bayna yadayh najwaakum sadaqa. Subhanallah. O you who believe, when you seek consultation from Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, when you just come to seek advice from the messenger, offer sadaqa before you even go to Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. This is the command of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in the Quran. Is there any human being ever on the face of the earth ever existed who could demand that kind of rights from people? None whatsoever, except Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Ya ayyuhalladhina amanu la tuqaddimu bayna yaday Allahi wa rasulihi. O you who believe, be not forward in the presence of Allah and His Messenger. Don't exceed the limits of Allah and His Messenger. In Surah Hujurat, another place, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in ayah number 2, Ya ayyuhal ladhina amanu la tarfa'u aswatakum fawqa sawti an-nabiy wa la tajharu lahu bil qawli kajahri ba'dikum li ba'd. O you who believe, lift not your voices above the voice of Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, nor shout when speaking to him as you shout to one another. The believers are reminded that even raising their voices above the voice of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam was not permitted. And in the tafsir, if you go and read, many of the scholars have said that is valid as much as it was in the time of Rasulullah alive. It is still valid today that when we are talking about Rasulullah, we must not raise our voices. How many times we see each other reminding of a hadith, and then we get upset if somebody disagrees and not realizing that what are we talking about? We're talking about a hadith, and if somebody takes it, doesn't take it, you don't go beyond the limits. You don't go hurting your own Muslim brothers, trying to remind them of a hadith and negating their rights upon you of respect. Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam must be respected as it was he was respected at the time while he was alive. Today, the same conditions apply until the day of judgment. The conditions will be the same to follow the example of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, the same way that the Sahaba followed him at that time. I mean, Abdullah bin Umar radiallahu ta'ala anhu was walking with another Sahabi and on a path and came and he went around. The path is straight and he went around the path and walked around. Another Sahabi asked him, he said, why you just leave the straight path and walk around? And he said, there used to be a tree here and Rasulullah used to walk around it. So I wanted to walk around the way Rasulullah walked. My dear brothers and sisters, how many of us, when we go to Hajj or Umrah in the cities of Mecca and Medina, how many of us do take that understanding with us that these are the same grounds that Rasulullah and all those great Sahabas walked on? Not only Rasulullah and those great Sahabas, but so many Anbiyas before him. The masjid in Mina has been said that in a hadith of Rasulullah that 70,000 Anbiya have made salah in that masjid, in that area, in that place. We are in the area, in the place where the greatest of the people walked around. And Allah addresses one of them to be the most greatest of the personalities of all human beings, which is Rasulullah in such a respectful manner. What do we deserve to do? Where do we stand when it comes to our beloved Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam? The most respect that we can give to Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam is try our best to follow his seerah, to follow his example. We as human beings know that we are not going to be able to do that 100%, but we must keep trying our best, because the more we try to follow his example sallallahu alaihi wasallam, the better off we are going to be in this dunya and better off we are going to be in the akhirah as well. My dear brothers and sisters, I remind myself first before anyone else that may Allah make us among those who are truly followers of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and true followers of the command of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Aqulu qawli hadha wa astaghfiru lakum. Thank you. Alhamdulillah. Alhamdulillah والصلاة والسلام على رسول الله. إن الله ملائكته يصلون على النبي يا أيها الذين آمنوا صلوا عليه وسلموا تسليما. اللهم صل على محمد وعلى آل محمد كما صليت على إبراهيم وعلى آل إبراهيم إنك حميد مجيد. اللهم بارك على محمد وعلى آل محمد كما باركت على إبراهيم وعلى آل إبراهيم في العالمين إنك حميد مجيد. In Surah Al-Hujurat, again Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, A'udhu billahi minash shaitanir rajeem. Inna alladhina yaghudduna aswatahum 'inda rasulillahi ulaika alladhina imtahana Allahu qulubahum lit-taqwa lahum maghfiratun wa ajrun 'azeem. They who subdue their voices in the presence of the Messenger of Allah, those are they whose hearts Allah have proven unto righteousness. Theirs will be forgiveness and immense reward. So in one surah, one ayah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala reminded us and commanded us to not raise our voice. And then Allah says that those of us who do that will be rewarded immensely, tremendously. And as I said earlier, in one of the examples of one of the Salaf, saying Imam Ibn al-Arabi said that after his death, meaning Rasulullah, his words are held in similar honor. So when his hadith is mentioned, no one should raise his voice over it or ignore it. So as I said earlier, that many ulama have the same opinion that the words of Rasulullah should be respected, not just in our actions, but also when we are talking about Rasulullah, we put the proper respect, we put the proper adab when it comes to discussing the hadith or talking about the seerah of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. It was not even permitted for the believers to leave the company of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam without taking the permission before. And I said earlier that inshallah I'm just touching base on the few ayahs from the Quran. This is not a comprehensive study of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. As you know, volumes and volumes and books have been written, and classes after classes have been given. So this is just to remind ourselves that Rasulullah was not an ordinary man. He was chosen by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to be his messenger, to bring the message to the humanity, and he should be respected and honored in the proper way. A'udhu billahi min shaitanir rajim. Innamal mu'minuna allatheena amanu billahi wa rasulihi وإذا كانوا معه على أمر جامع لهم يذهبوا حتى يتأذنوا. They only are the true believers who believe in Allah and His Messenger, and when they are with Him on some meeting or errand, go not away until they are asked, leave from Him sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And Sahabas were asked, of course, again at the time of Rasulullah, this ayah to remind them to do not do things that would annoy Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Of course, that holds true as much today as well, as not to do things that you know would be disliked by Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And again, in the Quran, in Surah Al-Ahzab, Allah says, وَمَا كَانَ لَكُمْ أَن تُعُدُّوا رَسُولُ اللَّهِ وَلَا أَن تَنْكِهُ أَزْوَاجَهُ مِنْ بَعْدِهِ أَبَدًا. And it is not for you to cause annoyance to the Messenger of Allah, nor that you should ever marry his wife after him. So these were the commands that was issued to the wives of Rasulullah, and they became mothers of the believers. And his wives were also not ordinary, they were not allowed to marry after him. So all these things indicate that Rasulullah were not just an ordinary person. It is important to remind ourselves, and those who may think that Quran is the only thing that we must follow, maybe we need to look at the Quran again and again, because Quran, the example of the Quran is Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. They go hand in hand. You learn the Quran from Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and you practice the Quran in your life as Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam did in his life himself. As Allah says in the Quran, Ya ayyuhal lazeena amanu atiyu Allah wa atiyu Rasul. O you who believe, obey Allah and obey the Messenger. So this is again the ta'ah, the submission to the will of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in obeying Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is the same as obeying Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The ibadah, as of course I mentioned again, is only for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We do not worship Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. We do not seek dua from him. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But we know, and the way that we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is to be shown to us by Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in the dua that he has shown to us, and the dua that he recited from beginning of the day till the end of the day, one after the other, when you wake up what you say, when you go to sleep what you say, when you eat what you say, when you enter the masjid what you say, when you enter the market what you say, all these du'as coming from Rasulullah, but all of these du'as is to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala only. And as Rasulullah has reminded us, that do not overpraise him to the point as the Nasranis, the Christians praised Isa alayhi salam and took him to the level at some time to Allah himself or sometime to Allah's son, a'udhu billahi min zalik. We don't take Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam ever to mean in that way, never. But we don't bring Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam down to just any regular human beings either. He was Bashar. You know it, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said it in the Quran. Allah told us that he was Bashar, he was a human being. He came into this world and he died. So we don't elevate Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam to that point, but we give him the due respect that is to him. As in Surah Taha, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, inna rabbakum ar-rahmanu fattabi'uni wa ati'u wa amri. So follow me and obey my order. وَمَا كَانَ لِلْمُؤْمِنِينَ وَالْمُؤْمِنَاتِ إِذَا قَضَى اللَّهُ وَرَسُولُهُ أَمْرًا أَنْ يَكُونَ لَهُمُ الْخَيْرَةُ مِنْ أَمْرِهِ. It is not fitting for a believer, man or woman, when a matter has been decided by Allah and His Messenger, to have any option about their decision. If anyone disobeys Allah and His Messenger, he is indeed on a clearly wrong path. This is again to understand that when the command of Allah and His Rasul comes, we must obey and follow. And if our weaknesses don't allow us to follow them in its entirety, let's not negate those commands either. We must be sincere to Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, as Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in Surah Tawbah reminds us, إِذَا نَصْحُ لِلَّهِ وَرَسُولِهِ مَا عَلَى الْمُحْسِنِينَ مِنْ سَبِيلِ وَاللَّهُ غَفُورٌ رَحِيمٌ. If they are true to Allah and His Messenger, not unto the good is there any road of blame. Allah is forgiving and all merciful. My dear brothers and sisters, inshallah, if in the last that I can just remind ourselves this in Surah Al-Nur that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, and maybe it could be an excellent advice for us to remember, وَاطِعُوا الرَّسُولَ لَعَلَّكُمْ تُرْحَمُونَ. وَاطِعُوا الرَّسُولَ لَعَلَّكُمْ تُرْحَمُونَ. And obey the Messenger that you may receive mercy. And obey the Messenger, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, so you may receive mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. My dear brothers and sisters, as I said, that anyone who thinks that Rasulullah was just an ordinary man is mistaken. And anyone who thinks that Rasulullah was up to the level of Allah is totally mistaken. But Rasulullah was a messenger or a Rasul who was given the guidance through the Quran and who showed to us as how to live, how to practice, how to act upon it, our lives as well. The best of the example was of the example of Rasulullah. The best of the guidance is the guidance of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and the example is of Rasulullah has shown to us by him, you know, himself in all the examples. So inshallah Aziz, I request myself, of course urge myself and request you to continue to make all the efforts that we can in our life. We are weak human beings. We make mistakes. We do correct wrong things. We do slip and slide. We go to the direction that is not accepted by Allah and His Messenger. But the doors of Tawbah are always open. Ar-Rahman does not close the doors for us ever unless and until we take shaitan into our hearts to the point where our hearts are sealed and seized and we don't listen and obey to these commands anymore. This is a reminder to myself first and to you again that Rasulullah's example is the best to follow, and hoping inshallah that we will make it into our lives a regular practice of trying to follow the example of Rasulullah. It is not a befitting for a believer to just ignore what is being said by Allah and His Messenger and not listen and try to obey those commands. I ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that if there is any mistake that I have made in this, then may Allah forgive me, because that mistake was my own and from the shaitan within myself. And I ask Allah to remove it from our hearts and our minds. If there is anything good that has come out of it, it's from Allah and Allah only. And we thank Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for all that good that comes from Him. And we ask Allah to continue to bless His blessings and His forgiveness and His showers of mercy upon us on regular basis. We are weak human beings. We seek His maghfirah. We seek His guidance. We seek His counsel at all times. And we ask Allah to make us amongst those who believe and listen to His counsel and follow what has been given to us in the Quran and in the seerah of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam.
إن الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا، من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلله فلا هادي له، وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك ولا مثيل ولا بداية ولا نهاية له، كيف الكيف فلا كيف له، أين العين فلا أين له، ليس كمثله شيء وهو السميع البصير. وأشهد أن سيدنا وقائدنا وقرة أعيننا محمد رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم بلغ الرسالة وأدى الأمانة ونصح الأمة فكشف الله به عنها الغمة. أما بعد، عباد الله، أوصي نفسي وإياكم بتقوى الله العلي العظيم. يقول الله سبحانه وتعالى: يا أيها النبي إنا أرسلناك شاهدا ومبشرا ونذيرا وداعيا إلى الله بإذنه وسراجا منيرا. Praise be to Allah, to the creator of the world. I bear witness there is absolutely nothing worthy to be worshipped except Allah, the creator of this universe, who has no beginning and has no end to his existence, who does not resemble the of his creation. I bear witness Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is the chosen and the best prophet and the best of mankind. I remind myself and remind you to be steadfast wholeheartedly to follow the commandment of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in all places, in all circumstances. Thereafter, Allah mentioned in this ayah, O Prophet, we have sent to you as a witness and giver of the good news of paradise, a warner from the torment of Allah, and call to Allah as per His order and as lantern of enlightenment. This is a very special month, my dear respected brothers and sisters in Islam. The best month of all the months is the month of Ramadan. The best day of the best of the week is the day of Friday. The best day of the year is the day of Arafah. And also the best month is the month of Rabi'ul Awwal. This is the month that Rasulullah Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was born. And he is the beacon of light to all mankind. Rasulullah Muhammad has a lot of fadl on us. He's special. He's very important. He's the best prophet of all the prophets. Because of him, we are gathered in this masjid and pray. Because of his teaching, we pray. Because of his teaching we fast. Because of his risala, we are all united from all walk of life. And background came united, following the commandment of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala by declaring La ilaha illallah Muhammadur Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So how can we do not love Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam? A lot of amazing miracles happened before he was born and continued his miracle after he was born. 9 prophets came in and giving the good news to the mother of Prophet Adam, Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Starting first from whom? Prophet Adam. And Prophet Adam, when he came in, he said the first month, which is the month of Rajab, and she saw him. فَقُلْتُ لَهُ سَيِّدِي مَلَتَ Who are you, sir? And he said, Adam. فَقُلْتُ مَا تُرِيدُ يَا أَبَا الْبَشَرِ What do you want, O the father of all mankind? And he replied by saying, قَالَ أَبْشِرِي يَا آمِنَ Amina B, have a good news that you are carrying the best of mankind بسيد البشر وفخر ربيعة ونظر وَمَنْ يَشَّقُ لَهُ الْقَبَرُ وَيُسَلِّمُ عَلَيْهِ الْحَجَرُ وَيَسْعَى إِلَىٰ خِدْمَتِهِ الشَّجَرُ She said, he said to her, you are carrying the best creation of the creation entirely. And descriptive information that among the miracles that he is going to have is the tree is going to speak to him. Yes, the tree did speak to him. When he became a prophet, he saw a Bedouin man. Bukhari mentioned, he said, believe in me, I am the prophet of Allah. The Bedouin said, what is your proof? The prophet said, this tree is my proof. He said, let it prove. Does the tree usually walk? No, the tree walk. And it reached them at the spot and testify there is nothing to be worshipped except Allah. And Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is the prophet of Allah. And a man when he saw this testification became a Muslim. That is what Prophet Adam was talking about. That is coming. This is the current person that you are carrying. Second month, Prophet Sheed came in and tell her the good news. And he said, third came Prophet Idris. Going to each one of them is required a whole dedicated hours of explanation. I'm just touching it quickly so that you have an idea what has taken place. Every month a Prophet of Allah was coming to give us the good news to the mother of Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And on the third Prophet Idris, when he came in, and فَقُلْتُ وَمَا تُرِيدُ يَا Idris, oh Idris, what do you want? And Idris replied, Prophet Idris, قَالَ أَبْشِرِي هَامِنَا فَقَدْ حَمَلْتِ بِالنَّبِيِّ الرَّئِيسِ وَالْجَوْهِرِ النَّفِيسِ صَاحِبِ التَّصْفِيحِ وَالتَّرْدِيسِ You are carrying the best of all the imams, the leaders of all leaders. And each month, and Prophet Nur on the fourth month, and fifth, and the fifth month Prophet Hud, on the sixth month Prophet Ibrahim, on the seventh month Prophet Ismail, on the eighth month Prophet Musa, on the ninth month Prophet Isa, each one of them coming, congratulating the Prophet's mother that she is carrying the best of the creation. Allahu Akbar. Allahu Akbar. Now, with this enlightenment and happiness, why there are fierce objection to some people? What is their problems? Why are they equating, commemorating the birth as if one really making a crime? Is it a crime? No. Is it a sin? No. Where did they get it from? They get it from their hawa, from their shaitan. وَزَيَّنَ لَهُمُ الْأَعْمَالُ وَزَيَّنَ الشَّيْطَانُ لَهُمُ الْأَعْمَالُ Shaitan beautify the work for the person. What is their basis? They say the hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. The first argument they said, did the Prophet commemorate his birth? Yes, he did. How? He said, this is the day. He was asked on the Monday why he fast. He said, this is the day I was born, that's why I'm fasting. Yes, he did celebrate his birthday. Now, is it not Fasting is ibadah, yes. Is it not ibadah giving charity? Yes. Is it not ibadah reviewing his seerah when the Muslim gather? Yes. Is it not ibadah coming collectively reading the Quran? Yes. Allahu Akbar. Is it not ibadah coming collectively making dhikr? Yes. وذاكرين الله وذاكراتي. Surah Al-Ahzab, Ayah 35, open it. Allah did not prohibit it. Then why did they object? They say, well, hadith, there is a hadith. What is the hadith saying? كل محدثة بدعة وكل بدعة ضلالة وكل ضلالة في النار. This is their argument using this hadith. Every innovation is misguided according to their understanding. Therefore, every innovation that are misguided is going to end up in hellfire. That's scary when you see this statement. Is the hadith sahih? Yes. Does the hadith have a proper explanation? Yes. By who? Ibn Hajar al-Asqalani, Imam al-Nawawi, those who are qualified ulama, who are in the sense of hadith, qualified to interpret the saying of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. What do they say it means? I, the vast majority, might entail that our innovation of misguidance, but this doesn't mean literally every innovation is misguided. Imam Bukhari did not say this. Imam Shafi'i did not understand this. Imam Shafi'i, contrary to this, in fact, he said innovations are too classified. Imam al-Bayhaqi mentioned the saying of Imam Shafi'i. He said, al-muhdathati naw'an, innovation has two kinds. Innovation of guidance and innovation of misguidance. Imam Shafi'i. Check out, Imam al-Bayhaqi mentioned in his salat the saying of Imam al-Shafi'i. Imam al-Shafi'i, where did he just get it from? That the innovation are two types, from the hadith of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. The first hadith, he used the hadith of Imam Muslim. مَنْ سَنَّ فِي الْإِسْلَامِ سُنَّةً حَسَنَةً فَلَهُ أَجْرُهَا وَأَجْرُ مَنْ عَمِنَ بِهِ وَلَا يَنْقُصُ مِنْ أُجُورِهِ شَيْءٍ ومن سن في الإسلام سنة سيئة فعليه وزرها ووزر من عمل بها ولا ينقص من أوزاره شيء. This is the hadith of the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم. He permitted in his lifetime to innovate things that does not contradict with the Quran and the hadith of Prophet Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم. Now it is not to you and me, we sit down and come up with innovation and do things the way we really think. No. It is a job of the scholars who validate, they took in that innovation and check it out in the light of the Quran and the Sunnah. If they concluded that this does not contradict the Quran and the Sunnah, then that would be innovation of guidance. And we're going to shed some light as an example what we are talking about. Now, innovation, as they understood, if they are sticking to just one way, say, كُلُّ مُحْدِثَةٍ بِدْعَةٍ. It says, كُلُّ كَافٍ لَمْ every. Well, we follow up and ask them this question. Does the Prophet's hadith contradict each other or support each other? If they say, support each other, that's fine, that's true. Now we ask you another hadith, that interpreted hadith, the ulama used it. The Prophet said in another hadith, كُلُّ عَيْنٍ زَانِيَةٍ. It's a hadith too. كُلُّ عَيْنٍ زَانِيَةٍ. What are you going to say to this hadith? Does that mean every eye also is committed adultery? Hayata, come on. Is the eyes of the Prophets that are committed adultery? Because they have eyes too. What about the angel? The angel are ma'asumeen. What about the angel is the eye? They have eye too. You say every innovation entails us, every innovation, no exception. This hadith also say every eye. What do you say then? And they say, no, this is not true. Well, that's the same thing to that. Every innovation, it means the vast majority of innovation are misguided, not every innovation. Now we go to the examples of innovation that are taking place after the birth of Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Imam Ibn Hajar mentioned the Jum'ah Adhan at the time of Prophet was one. was added after the Idina Uthman's time, was two Adhan. That's innovation too. At his lifetime, Imam Bukhari mentioned, a man after him said, Sami'a Allah liman hamida. لك الحمد. Then what did he say? من السماوات ومن الأرض ومن ما شئت من شيء بعده. The Prophet did not taught him specifically to add this dua. Who's the Prophet after the salah was over? He said, who was the third person who was making this dua? The companion said, me. He said, I have seen 30 or somewhat angels were rushing to write it down. He did not say, how do you say and make dua things that I did not say? The Prophet at his lifetime. Innovation of misguidance that also took place is the Quran that we have in our hand was not done at the time of Sayyidina Umar, Sayyidina Abu Bakr, Sayyidina Uthman, Sayyidina Ali. The dot on the back one and the lead for the tattoo and Kisra, Dhumma, all this are taking place way out. Imam Abu Dawud mentioned in his book, Kitab al-Masahib, section. Who innovated this? His name is Yahya ibn Ya'mar. Yahya ibn Ya'mar. He is the one who innovated this. If they say this innovation is all bad, then the ulama said, go back to the original book that was written at the time of Sayyidina Uthman. It is the Museum of Turkey waiting for you. Go there, learn it from it, stick to it. Then once it is applied to you, then talk about it. The Quran that we have in our hand is innovated, innovation of guidance, not innovation of misguidance. The innovation of guidance that was took place after the Prophet, when the Prophet was sent letter, Muhammad ibn Abdullah, what it says. When was it added? Muhammad Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, afterward. Afterward. That's innovation of guidance too. Now, the ulama did not prohibit this. The innovation of guidance also is the manarat that we see, the mihrab that we see. At the time of Rasulullah, Sayyidina Abu Bakr, Sayyidina Umar, Sayyidina Ali was not there. Was innovated on 99 Hijriya year at the time of Umar ibn Abdul Aziz. He is the one who innovated. He said, when a person comes to the masjid, it will be easy if we have the mihrab to tell where is the direction of the Qibla. Was it not the case? Is it not helpful? Yes. As a result, we have that mihrab. But their indoctrination teaches you that is also innovative. Guess what? In my country, in Ethiopia, 119 masajid was demolished in the name of bid'ah. Allahu Akbar. The authority is looking for them. Why? Because they say the minaret that are told was not existed at the time of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. This is innovation. You see how it's difficult to build one masjid. This is a crime, my brothers and sisters. And they demolish 119 masjid in the name of bid'ah. People are losing their lives, some of them, in the name of bid'ah. They consider you are a sinner. Now, when it comes to the Mawlid, what is the scholars talked about? Imam Hafidh As-Suyuti, he wrote a book called it Hasan al-Masjid fi Amal al-Mawlid. فقد وقع السؤال عن عمل المولد النبوي في شهر ربيع الأول ما حكمه من حيث الشرعي. He was questioned, what is the Islamic judgment commemorating the birth of our Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam? He cited the evidence. He said, in this book, Hasan al-Masjid fi Amal al-Mawlid. In the Mawlid, he said, people gather together, review the seerah of Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, eating food, reading the Quran, it is innovation of guidance. It is something good to do. So it's not haram. Ibn Kathir, in his book, mentioned Al-Bidayah wal-Nihayah, who actually innovated this innovation of guidance of commemorating the Mawlid, Al-Malik al-Mudaffar, a pious leader, who was the king at the time in what is called today Iraq, in the Erbil area. He was the king, Al-Malik al-Mudaffar. He did not just came up with this thing to do. In the 7th century, he started this innovation. He gathered the scholars. Ibn Dihya was a scholar in his time, the science of hadith. He asked him, Allah gave me a hand to innovate this thing, what do you say? Ibn Dihya wrote a book and gave him a hadiyya, a gift, the basis of commemorating is something good. He is the one who innovated this innovation. Yes, at the time of Prophet, did not commemorate. Yes, at the time of Sahaba, did not commemorate. Well, similarly, as we said, to all these good innovations that are taking place, none of the things that we have was at the time of the Sahaba. The Prophet did not use microphone to deliver his khutbah. What are we going to do to the mic? Turn it off? The Prophet did not use in his masjid this carpet that we have. What are you going to do? The Prophet did not use this lineup that we have. What are you going to do? You check it out, apply it to yourself. It is impossible. He permitted مَنْ سَنَّ فِي الْإِسْلَامِ سُنَّةً حَسَنَةً. Who innovated good innovation, he will be rewarded. The Prophet said, Imam al-Bayhaqi mentioned what Imam al-Shafi'i used it. He allowed it in his lifetime. So ignorance is our enemy. We need to declare war on our ignorance and show the love of Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. The love of Allah is blocked unless we love who? Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. قُلْ إِن كُنْتُمْ تُحِبُّونَ اللَّهَ فَاتَّبِعُونِي يُحْبِبْكُمُ اللَّهُ. If we indeed love Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, how do you want to know the love of Allah that you have without following every step to the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam? Now, another message to those who say we love the Qasaid at the time of Mawlid, yet they do not pray. You do not follow Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. You say, yes, I love the dhikr. Yes, at the time of Mawlid, I want to participate, but I don't fast. You are not a good Muslim. If you truly love Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, stand for what he preached. Stand for what he stand for. Love what he loves. Reject what he rejects. Then you will be with those whom Allah loves the best. Because, my dear respected brothers and sisters, loving the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam had nothing but benefit. Time is short. In conclusion, I will say, have no doubt to commemorate the birth of Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Something is permissible, provided you do not mix it male and female and bring in a guitar and bring in organ, say, we really love Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. No, you are mixing good with bad. Take the bad out. Don't mix the two genders. Have them in separate spot. But you can have your chant. Yes, you can have the reading of the Quran and give the salah, all good things. It is proven, inshallah ta'ala, you will see in your life commemorating this with love and conviction, you will see the result. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala enable us to love Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam as he should be and help us to follow him wholeheartedly all the time. أَقُولُ قَوْلِ هَذَا وَأَسْتَغْفِرُ اللَّهَ وَلِيِّ وَلَكُمْ وَأَسْتَغْفِرُهُ يَا قَوْلَ الْمُسْتَغْفِرِينَ أَسْتَغْفِرُ اللَّهَ. الحمد لله نحمده ونستغفره ونستعينه ونستهديه ونشكره ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا. من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلا هادي له. وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك ولا مثيل ولا بداية له. وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله وصفيه وحبيبه طب القلوب ودوائها وعافية الأبدان وشفاؤها ونور الأبصار وضياؤها. في ذكراك سيدي يا رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم أوصي نفسي وإياكم بتقوى الله العلي العظيم. يقول الله سبحانه وتعالى لقد جاءكم رسول من أنفسكم عزيز عليه ما عنتم حريص عليكم بالمؤمنين رؤوف رحيم. هو محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم. ومعنى محمد من كثر حمد الناس له لكثرة خصاله الحميدة. هو محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم النبي الأمي الذي أوحى إليه كتابا يعجز الفصحاء وجاء يهدي يتبعه فيه العلماء والحكماء. وقد ورد في الحديث أن الله تعالى قال لآدم: لولا محمد ما خلقتك. معناه خلقت الدنيا لأظهر محمدا صفوتها، أي أشرف الخلق صلى الله عليه وسلم. أتت أمه في المنام فقال لها: إنك قد حملت بسيد العالمين وخير البرية، فسميه إذا وضعته محمدا فإنه ستحمد عقباه. إخوة الإيمان، هو محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم. فعليكم بطاعة الله وكثرة الصلاة على صاحب الكتاب والسنة. وقد قال صلى الله عليه وسلم: أكثركم علي صلاة، أكثركم أزواجا في الجنة. عباد الله، إن الله وملائكته يصلون على النبي: يا أيها الذين آمنوا صلوا عليه وسلموا تسليما. اللهم صل وسلم على سيدنا محمد وعلى آله وأصحابه على ما كان وما يكون. اللهم صل وسلم عليه وارض اللهم عن الأربعة الخلفاء وبقية العشرة الكرام وأزواج نبيك المصطفى وعن أمي حبيبك وسطيه الإخلاص والصفا وعن الأنصار والمهاجرين والتابعين إلى يوم يبعثون. اللهم إنا نسألك أن تعز الإسلام برحمتك يا أرحم الراحمين. اللهم اغفر للمؤمنين والمؤمنات الأحياء منهم والأموات، إنك قريب مجيب الدعوات. اللهم اشفي مرضانا وعافي مبتلانا وفك أسرانا وارحم موتانا واقضي حوائجنا وحبب إلينا نبينا محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم. اللهم أرنا الحق حقا وارزقنا اتباعه، وأرنا الباطل باطلا وارزقنا اجتنابه. اللهم اضرب الكافرين بالكافرين، وأخرج المسلمين من بين أيديهم سالمين. اللهم اجعل ذرياتنا مثل ذريات الصحابة، واجعل أزواجنا مثل أزواج الصحابة، واجعلنا نقتدي بالصحابة رضوان الله تعالى عليهم أجمعين. عباد الله، إن الله يأمر بالعدل والإحسان وإيتاء ذي القربى وينهى عن الفحشاء والمنكر والبغي، يعظكم لعلكم تذكرون. فاذكروا الله العظيم يذكركم، واشكروا على نعمه يزدكم، ولذكر الله أكبر، والله يعلم ما تصنعون. أقم الصلاة.
الحمد لله نحمده ونشكره، نستعين به جل وعلا ونستهديه ونستغفره، ونعوذ به سبحانه وتعالى من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا. من يهده الله فهو المهتد، ومن يضلل فلن تجد له وليا مرشدا. عباد الله، أنصحكم ونفسي الآثمة بتقوى الله، أحثكم وإياها على طاعته، أحذركم وإياها وبال مخالفته ومعصيته. أشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له، ولا شيء مثله، ولا شيء قبله، ولا شيء معه، قديم بلا ابتداء، دائما بلا انتهاء، لا يفنى ولا يبيد، ولا يكون إلا ما يريد، لا تبلغه الأوهام ولا تدركه الأفهام، ولا يشبه الأنام، حي لا يموت، قيوم لا ينام، سبحانه لا مثل له ولا مثال له ولا مثيل له ولا مماثل له، ذلك بأنه جل وعلا موصوف بصفات الوحدانية، منعوت بنعوت الفردانية، ليس في معناه أحد من البرية، تعالى عن الحدود والغايات والأركان والأعضاء والأدوات، لا تحويه الجهات الست كسائر المبتدعات. وأشهد أن سيدنا وحبيبنا وعظيمنا ونبينا وشفيعنا وقرة أعيننا محمد صلى الله عليه وآله وسلم عبد الله ورسوله وصفيه من خلقه وخليله، أرسله بالهدى ودين الحق ليظهره على الدين كله ولو كره الكافرون. اللهم صل وسلم وبارك وضاعف وجدد ومجد على هذا النبي الأمين وعلى آله الطيبين الطاهرين، ورضي الله عن صحابته الغر الميامين وعمن اتبعهم بإحسان وتمسك بالثقلين إلى يوم الدين. أما بعد، يقول الله سبحانه وتعالى في المحكم بعد أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم: بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. أولم يكفهم أن أنزلنا عليك الكتاب يتلى عليهم إن في ذلك لرحمة وذكرى لقوم يؤمنون. الآية في سورة العنكبوت. And the ayah is beautiful. Of course, all the ayahs of the Quran are beautiful. But this ayah has a unique perspective on things. It's Allah says, أَوَلَمْ يَكْفِهِمْ أَنَّا أَنزَلْنَا عَلَيْكَ الْكِتَابِ يُتْلَى عَلَيْهِمْ. Isn't enough for them that we have revealed the book on you and the book is being recited on them? Isn't that enough for them that they have received the book that is revealed to you and is recited on them? إِنَّ فِي ذَٰلِكَ لَرَحْمَةً. In this, in that recitation of the Quran, إِنَّ فِي ذَٰلِكَ لَرَحْمَةً, and in the revealing of the Quran, لَرَحْمَةً وَذِكْرَى لِقَوْمٍ يُؤْمِنُونَ. There is rahmah and there is a reminder for those who believe. Among the khasa'as of this ummah, al-umma al-muhammadiyyah, ala sahbiha wa ali afdhalus salaam wa azkiyas salaam, among the khasa'as of this ummah, and the greatest manqaba of this ummah, of course, is among the greatest manqabas of the ummah, is al-kitab al-azim, kitab Allah, al-Qur'an al-Kareem. And al-Qur'an al-Kareem, and oftentimes we talk about the miracles of the prophets alayhi wa salaam, and we talk about the miracles of Isa, and we talk about the miracles of Musa and the miracles of Ibrahim, Nuh, etc. And oftentimes, because people look at things from many different perspectives, they don't see the greatest miracle of all and the lasting miracle of all, which is the miracle of the book of Allah in itself. And that's where the ayah comes, أَوَلَمْ يَكْفِهِمْ. Is it enough for them? أَنَّا نَزَلْنَا عَلَيْكَ الْكِتَابِ, that we have revealed the book on you and is recited on them. But who is reminded? إِنَّ فِي ذَلِكَ لَذِكْرَى أَفَوَإِنَّ فِي ذَلِكَ لَرَحْمَةً وَذِكْرَى لِقَوْمٍ يُؤْمِنُونَ. طيب. القرآن الكريم تفصيل. There is details in it for things. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says it. Now, in another time, another ayah, he says, there is rahmah. فِيهِ شِفَاءٌ. There is shifa. فِيهِ شِفَاءٌ لِلنَّاس also. رَحْمَةٌ وَشِفَاءٌ. Mercy and cure, purification. More than that, there is elevation of the maqam. Among the times that are special for Al-Qur'an al-Kareem is the month of Ramadan. Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. شهر رمضان الذي أنزل فيه القرآن. The month of Ramadan that Al-Qur'an was revealed in. Look at the seerah. When we go back to the seerah of Nabi al-A'zam sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, we see that in the seerah of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, in the month of Ramadan, every night of the month of Ramadan, there was a halaqa of Qur'an. A Qur'anic halaqa, special. This Qur'anic halaqa in the month of Ramadan was between al-Habib al-A'zam sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and his beloved Jibreel alayhi salam. Every night, there was a Qur'an gathering between the Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and Jibreel going over the Qur'an al-Azim. Notice. And that was continuous every single year until, of course, the year where the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam went to the next world. And Jibreel also did that twice. The halaqa was doubled now. Something special about Ramadan. And there is something special about the Qur'an and the connection of the Qur'an with Ramadan. Notice. So that the most beloved to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala dedicates his time every day on a private halaqa after the believers, after being with the Sahaba radiallahu anhum, after being taking care of the affairs of the mu'mineen, after all these things, him and Jibreel on their own are reciting that one Qur'an al-Azim. Not talking about the Taraweeh and the Qiyam and all these things. This is extra on top of that. So that Nabi al-A'zam sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was doing wisal, Qiyam al-wisal, so that he would not break his fast. He would fast Ramadan, the day after the day, without breaking his fast, 2, 3, 4, 5 days. As-Sahaba radiallahu anhu said, Ya Rasulullah, we will do the same thing. He said, no. قَالُوا إِنَّكَ تُوَاصِلْ. But you do it. He says, al-hadith is sahih. أنا لست كهيئتكم. I am not like you. أبيت عند ربي يطعمني ويسقيني. I am not like you. I stay at night with my Lord. He feeds me and he gives me drinks. Some people say, well, it's exaggeration. Hadith al-Sahihayn, look it up in the Sahih. See where the exaggeration is. Why should it be exaggeration when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala talks about Maryam alayha salam and he says, وَهُزِّ إِلَيْكِ بِجِذْعِ النَّخْلَةِ تُسَاقِطْ عَلَيْكِ رُطَبًا جَنِيًّا. All you have to do is simply tap the palm tree next to you. Ya Maryam, Allah tells us in the Quran, just tap the palm tree and all of a sudden the dates and all these things will come on you. Not only that, كُلَّمَا دَخَلَ عَلَيْهَا زَكَرِيَّ الْمِحْرَابِ وَجَدَ عِنْدَهَا رِزْقًا. Every time Zakaria entered the mihrab on Maryam, she's doing her ibadah. She's doing her ibadah. وَجَدَ عِنْدَهَا رِزْقًا. He found rizq. He found food. قَالَ يَا مَرْيَمْ أَنَّ لَكِ هَذَا. Where did he get this rizq from? How come some things that are not available, how come you're getting them? And right here in the mihrab, قَالَ هُوَ مِنْ عِنْدِ اللَّهِ. It is from Allah. So that is to Maryam alayha salam. Then how about the most beloved and more honorable to Allah than Maryam alayhi salam, Muhammadun Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi wa sallam. Notice, sometimes because we forget simple basic facts, so we have to be reminded by the Quran al-Kareem. Now, some people because nasallahu alayhi wa sallam. Anyway. Because there has been, unfortunately, a reason we have to do these examples because of the sensitivities of some people's hearts, whose hearts have been diseased against the Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi wa sallam. So that they think he's not worthy of these descriptions. That is exaggeration. That is beyond his status. And I always say, show me one word that one says, that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is not worthy of being described of. Rahmatullah al-Imam al-Busiri, Imam al-Busiri in his Burda, he says, فَاقَ النَّبِيِّينَ. He surpassed the Prophets. فَاقَ النَّبِيِّينَ فِي خَلْقٍ وَفِي خُلُقٍ وَلَمْ يُدَانُوهُ فِي عِلْمٍ وَلَا كَرَمٍ. He surpassed the Prophets in خَلْق and in خُلُق. And they have not got close to him in his knowledge and honor. And then he said, دَعْمَ الدَّعَدْهُ النَّصَارَى فِي نَبِيِّهِمِ وَحْكُمْ بِمَا شِئْتَ مَدْحًا فِيهِ وَاحْتَكِمِ فَإِنَّ قَدْرَ رَسُولِ اللَّهِ لَيْسَ يُدْرِكُهُ أَحَدٌ فَيُعْرِبَ عَنْهُ نَاطِقٌ بِفَمِ. Avoid what the Nasara claimed in their prophets. Do not say attributes of Allah to him. He is not the creator. He is the best of the creation, not the creator. And then ascribe to him anything other than that. وَانْصُرْ إِلَىٰ ذَاتِهِ مَا شِئْتَ مِنْ شَرَفٍ وَانْصُرْ إِلَىٰ قَدْرِهِ مَا شِئْتَ مِنْ عِظَمٍ. Ascribe to him whatever you want of glory. Ascribe to him whatever you want of wisdom. Because النبي الأعظم صلى الله عليه وسلم is the one who gave wisdom its meaning and who gave nur its light and who gave the understanding and the perfection its perfection صلى الله تعالى عليه وسلم. So we have to understand these things sometimes. لا تعمل دعوة النصارى في نبيهم. You know what he's saying? No Muslim on earth says that the Nabi صلى الله عليه وسلم has attributes of Allah. That's not a Muslim. But the love of the people to the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم makes them attribute him with things that I think he deserves much more than they attribute him with. بلغ العلماء العلامة السعدي رحمة الله عليه used to say, as you all know, بلغ العلا بكماله كشف الدجى بجماله حسنت أو كملت جميع خصاله صلوا عليه وآله. He has reached the perfection صلى الله تعالى عليه وسلم. And in that Hassan رضي الله عنه mentions, as you all know, he mentions the line that says, إنك لم ترى أطوعين. More beautiful. Look, this is the maqam. I want you in this month of Ramadan to move to the maqam of mahabba. All of us together, because I need it as well as you. Let's move our hearts to direct your qibla. I don't mean the qibla on salah. Qibla on salah to Mecca. But direct the qibla of your heart to Al-Madinah Al-Munawwara. Put the compass of your heart to Al-Masjid Al-Nabawi Al-Sharif. Put it to Al-Madinah. Open your heart to receive the nur of Al-Nabi sallallahu ta'ala alayhi wa sallam. And notice from the point, from the position of Mahabbah, where this Sahabi says, وَأَجْمَلُ مِنْكَ لَمْ تَرَى قَطْعِينَ. More beautiful than you, Ya Rasulullah, an eye has never seen. وَأَفْضَلُ مِنْكَ لَمْ تَلِدِ النِّسَاءُ. And better than you, women have never given birth to. خُلِقْتَ مُبَرَّأً مِنْ كُلِّ عَيْبٍ. You were created purified from any imperfection. كَأَنَّكَ قَدْ خُلِقْتَ كَمَا تَشَاءُ. As if you were created the way you wanted to be. أبيت عند ربي يطعمني ويسقيني. But also the hadith, we can benefit from it from other perspectives as well. Not only knowing about the maqam of al-Habib al-A'zam sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, but also realizing that there is a food for the soul. يطعمني ويسقيني. There is food here. There is drinks for the soul. Just like you drink, you feed your body. And this is where the ulama of Suluk went and said, just like you have to feed your body to live, you have to feed your soul, your ruh, to live. If you don't feed your body, what will happen to your body? You'll die. And if you don't feed the soul will die. In a sense, al-qalb will die. Huh? What is the food of the body? The food that you eat at the iftar. What is the food of the ruh and al-qalb? Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Ala bi-dhikri Allah. تَطْمَئِنُّ الْقُلُوبِ. The dhikr of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala makes hearts comfortable. في الصحيحين الحديث by Abu Huraira was as مثل الذي يذكر ربه والذي لا يذكر ربه. The example of the one who does dhikr to Allah and the one who doesn't do dhikr to Allah. كَمَثَلِ الْحَيِّ وَالْمَيِّتِ. Is the example of one who's dead and the one who is alive. The one who is dead and the one who is alive. So therefore there has to be the need for reviving the soul. And Al-Qur'an in Ramadan is the best of opportunities to do that. And that is the sunnah of Al-Habib sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Where you see him in Ramadan, he was with the Qur'an all the time. Not that he wasn't in other than Ramadan, not with the Qur'an. Al-Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he was a Qur'an. He was a walking Qur'an sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. But the connection in Ramadan was different to the Qur'an. So he can show me and you how to follow suit. How to deal with Al-Qur'an. Because we see Allah says, إِنَّ فِي ذَلِكَ لَرَحْمَةِ. Al-Qur'an has halawa, has tarawa, has sweetness, has rahmah when you read the Qur'an. The question is, do you feel the sweetness when you read the Qur'an? Do you feel the rahmah descending on you when you read the Qur'an? If you don't, then you have to question yourself. Why? Because some people recite the Qur'an like they recite a newspaper. Some people recite the Qur'an like they're reciting a newspaper. Sitting one leg up and one leg down and halfway here and halfway there. And this is the book of Allah. وَمَنْ يُعَظِّمْ شَعَائِرَ اللَّهِ فَإِنَّهَا مِنْ تَقْوَى الْقُلُوبِ. He who glorifies the شَعَائِرَ of Allah, it is from the taqwa of qulub. From taqwa of qulub. We have to ask ourselves, where is the Qur'an in our lives today? How many minutes are we spending in Ramadan, the connection of Ramadan, for many secrets? After the Qiyam and after all these things with Al-Qur'an al-Kareem. Al-Qur'an has things. And Allah tells us about the Qur'an. The people nowadays, they look for happiness. Ask anybody. From whatever background they are, they're looking always for happiness. How can I get happiness? How can I get happiness? How can I be happy? Al-Qur'an takes you to the happiness. How? Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. قُلْ بِفَضْلِ اللَّهِ وَبِرَحْمَتِهِ فَبِذَلِكَ فَلْيَفْرَحُ. Say, by the bounties of Allah and by the mercies, because of the mercies of Allah, they should be happy. فَلْيَفْرَحُ. They shall be happy. And order, be happy by the mercy, because of the mercy of Allah. The ayah means basically. هُوَ خَيْرٌ مِمَّا يَجْمَعُونَ. That's one. Allah orders you to be happy here. There's another ayah. إذ قال له أبو قارون إذ قال له قومه لا تفرح. His people told him, do not be happy to قارون. إن الله لا يحب الفرحين. Allah does not like those who are happy. Some people say, wait a minute, you just said Allah commands us to be happy. Another ayah, Allah does not like those who are happy. Yes. In one ayah, Allah wants you to be happy, but because of what? Because of the fadl of Allah, because of the mercies of Allah, because of the ni'mas of Allah. And Allah does not want you to be happy in the batin. Yani what does that mean? When you read the Quran, be happy. When you come to the salah, be happy. When you make dhikr to Allah, be happy. But don't be happy bil batin. Not don't be happy. Some people are happy when they steal. They steal something from somebody, they're happy, they think they gained something. Some people, they are happy when they fool people or cheat people. Some people, they are happy when they commit ma'asi and sins. That makes them happy. You see the point here? The difference between being one happy and between being happy on the other side. The Quran wants you to be happy. But when you are reading the Quran and you are interacting with Al-Quran Al-Kareem and you are feeling this sakina and feeling this rahmah of the Quran and feeling the tuma'ina and the sukoon and the peacefulness of the Quran, this is what should make you happy. Make that environment for yourself. When you sit and read the book of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, imagine the hadith al-sahih, sahih al-Muslim. من قال سبحان ربي العظيم الذي أعظم صلى الله عليه وسلم. And this is a gift for you this weekend. Inshallah, we all practice it this weekend and for the rest of weekends. But here's the gift, not from me, from Rasulullah صلى الله عليه وسلم to the Muslims. Look at this. Whoever says من قال سبحان ربي العظيم, whoever says سبحان ربي العظيم, غرست له نخلة في الجنة. Allah will put a palm tree under his name in Jannah. Subhan Rabbi al-Azim. That's all. Subhan Rabbi al-Azim. Look, but you have to feel the sweetness of dhikr. Feel the presence in the dhikr. Have the ikhlas in dhikr. Yes, then that will happen. Al-Quran, of course, we talk about Al-Quran Kareem. Look at Al-Quran Kareem. Let's go back to the ayah a little bit. أَوَلَمْ يَكْفِهِمْ Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, isn't it enough for them? أَوَلَمْ يَكْفِهِمْ أَنَّا أَنْزَلْنَا عَلَيْكَ كِتَابَ Isn't it enough for them that we have revealed the book on you, يُتْلَى عَلَيْهِمْ That is recited on them. Isn't that enough? Isn't that the greatest miracle? Let me show you a couple of examples. Reviving the death. Ibrahim alayhi salam, قَالَ رَبِّي أَرِنِي كَيْفَ تُحْيِي الْمَوْتَى And the Quran. Oh Allah, show me how you revive the dead. قال أولم تؤمن قال بلى ولكن يطمئن قلبي نعم. He says فخذ أربعة من الطير فصرهن إليك ثم اجعل على كل جبل منهن جزءا ثم ادعهن يأتينك سعيا. Put four birds on different mountains, part on each, and then call them. Parts of birds, call them, and they will come running to you. Another example also of reviving the dead. For example, the man. قَالَ أَنَّا يُحْيِي هَذِهِ اللَّهُ بَعْدَ مَوْتِهَا How can Allah revive this after it's dead? How can Allah revive it? Surah Al-Baqarah. فَأَمَاتَهُ اللَّهُ مِئَةَ عَامٍ ثُمَّ بَعْثَ Then Allah went for him, for that person who said this, to die 100 years. That man died 100 years, then Allah resurrected him. ثُمَّ بَعْثَ
But انظر now you are after 100 years.
انظر يا طعامك وشرابك لم يتسنى. Look at the food that you have and the drink that you had from 100 years ago, it's still the same. وانظر إلى حمارك and look at your donkey and your mule, it's still the same. نجعلك آية للناس. So you can be an ayah. So people can see because people want miracles. Show me. Here's the miracle. Take it. Now look at the example at the time of the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم. A man comes to a Nabi al-Azam sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi with the bone of a human being in his hand. He dug it from some grave, took it. Some people think they are like this, huh? But logic, it's their logic. So he brought this bone, al-Azam, mayyit, brought it to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and he started crushing the bone in his own hand. Crushing it. And he said, من يحيي العظام وهي رميم؟ من يحيي العظام وهي رميم؟ Who can revive this? Look at this bone. I'm crushing this bone, and you're telling me that the bone will come to life? Who can revive this bone after it's dead? See, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala here did not order the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam to say, "All right, let's make this human being over again," or "Let's get these birds." No, 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 no. Al-Quran answered, because Al-Quran is the greatest of all miracles. قل يحييها. Tell him by Quran. The answer is by Quran. قل يحييها الذي أنشأها أول مرة. وهو الذي جعلكم من شجر الأرض نارا فإذا أنتم منه توقدون. أليس الذي خلق السماوات والأرض والأرض قادرا على أن يخلق مثلهم؟ بلى وهو الخلاق. بلى وهو الخلاق العليم. إنما أمره إذا أراد شيئا أن يقول له كن. But notice Al-Khalaq, what does that mean? Al-Quran, I always remember, those of you who have been here, Al-Quran always presents simple questions with very deep answers. You're saying, I don't understand, where's the greatness here? It is great, but yeah, but point it out. I'll explain. But because I will explain, I'll ask you after you leave the Jum'ah to make salah on the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in your heart as well, and on your tongue, sallallahu ta'ala alayhi wa sallam. Here's the explanation. قل يحيي الذي أنشأها أول مرة. You're saying who's gonna revive this bone after it's crushed? Well, who created this bone to start with in the first place? Who created the bone from the state of non-existence من العدم إلى الوجود, from nothing into something? Who made it when there was no bones and no molecules and nothing, no particles? Made it particles. The one who made it from the state of non-existence into the state of existence, that is Allah Rabbul Alameen. This is Al-Khaliq. أَفَمَنْ يَخْلُقْ كَمَنْ لَا يَخْلُقْ. Is he who creates like the one who doesn't create? أَمْ خُلِقُوا مِنْ غَيْرِ شَيْءٍ أَمْ هُمُ الْخَالِقُونَ. Were they created from nothing or are they the creators? Look at the questions of the Quran. Very simple. Very deep, very profound. The ongoing message of the Quran al-Kareem. Like what is the Quran also? The Quran also, himayah, protection. Protection. Yeah. People always, they want to put, what do I do for protection? I have this and these people are doing this and this. And I think because I now I'm making some money, I think everybody is jealous and they have all these eyes, red eyes and black eyes and blue eyes. They colored all the eyes. Look at Al-Quran again. Look at Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, how he tells us. Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. وَمَنْ يَعْشُ عَنْ ذِكْرِ الرَّحْمَانِ نُقَيِّضْ لَهُ شَيْطَانًا فَهُوَ لَهُ قَرِينٌ. The ayah is simple. وَمَنْ يَعْشُ means he or she who avoids ذِكْرِ الرَّحْمَانِ, the book of Allah. إِنَّا نَحْنُ نَزَلْنَا الذِّكْرِ, the ذِكْرِ is the Quran. Whoever avoids the ذِكْرِ of Allah, the Quran of Allah, نُقَيِّضْ لَهُ شَيْطَانًا. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will have a shaytan with you and he will be accompanying you. Because what? The avoidance of the dhikr of the Quran al-Kareem. Therefore you see Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, when the man came to him, said, Ya Rasulullah, what do I do when I go to sleep? He says, إِذَا دَيْتَ فِرَاشَكْ. When you came, when you come to your bed, اقرأ Surah al-Kursi or Ayat al-Kursi. Recite the ayah of Kursi. لَا يَتِيكَ الشَّيْطَانَ. Shaytan will not come to you. Look at the Quran. You say one ayah, and a shaytan gets away, you are protected. When you go at home, before you put your bed, your head on that pillow, and think about the business that you have to do tomorrow, and think about the things that you have to do tomorrow, recite Surah Ayat al-Kursi, so you can be protected, and teach your children to recite al-Kursi as well. So Allah protects you, so you have the protection. فَإِذَا قَرَأْتَ الْقُرْآنَ جَعَلْنَا بَيْنَكَ وَبَيْنَ الَّذِينَ لَا يُؤْمِنُونَ حِجَابًا مَسْتُورًا. We will put a barrier when you recite the Quran. We will put a barrier between you and those who don't believe. Now what else? More than that. So the happiness, it is a, comes as a tarbiyah. Makes you a man. Makes you a woman. Makes you a perfect and a decent human being. Embodying Al-Quran Al-Kareem. Embodying the values of generosity, the values of wisdom, the values of decency, all these things. Moreover, something that you will find شفيع. النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم says في الحديث الصحيح اللي أخرج الحاكم وهو صحيح وأنا أجرت مسلم. It is صحيح according to Muslim's conditions. He says الصيام والقرآن يشفعان للعبد. وفي رواية يوم القيامة في مسند أحمد. Two things will be interceders, they will intercede for you on the day of judgment. الصيام and the Quran. Look at this. Al-Quran al-Kareem. أنت now you read the Quran al-Kareem. This Quran al-Kareem on the day of judgment will come and will intercede for you. Say, Ya Allah, this person used to read me all the time. Ya Allah, make me a barrier between him and Jahannam. This Quran. Therefore, take keep the Quran for yourself. Teach your little children. Bring them a Quran and establish this relation. This Quran will go with you all the way to the day of judgment. في يوم القيامة. And this Quran will stand and will testify in the court of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that you are reading and you are reciting. Establish your connection with the Quran. Bring your children, your little girl, your little boy, your wife, bring her a Quran. Read, make a mark in that Quran. Every day, even 7 ayahs, 5 ayahs. But make it a ritual, a routine that you're reciting Al-Qur'an every single day and keep that copy of Al-Qur'an not on the shelves, but in your heart, in the shelves of your heart. So it can come and testify for you as if you keep it on the shelves of your library, it will testify against you. Ya Rabbi, inna qawmi takhadu hadha Al-Qur'an mahjura. Oh Allah, Al-Qur'an will come, their judgment says, Oh Allah, my people who were put me in their library, they left me abandoned, mahjur. They left me aside, they abandoned me. Establish these things, open up the oasis of Al-Quran al-Azim. أقول لكم يا هذا أستاذ. الحمد لله حين كثير الرحمن الرحيم ولا اله الا الله وحده لا شريك له وهو على من جحد به وكفر اشهد ان سيدنا محمدا صلى الله عليه وعلى اله وسلم خاتم الانبياء المحتفى صلى الله عليه وسلم وبارك على هذا النبي وعلى اله اهل الفقه والنظر والعلم والاثر وعلى من باثاره مقتفى واعتبر. There is a way for us to get to the mercy of the Quran. And to get to the mercy of the Quran, there has to be adab with the Quran, first of all. Adab with the Quran. And the ulama of Qulub, they say, well, the adab is different kinds because we want to be happy. Everybody seeks happiness, sa'ada. But the happiness is not in the money. See, ask those who have lots of money. Ask them. Every day calculate. You can't sleep the whole night calculating what's going to happen tomorrow. But the one who doesn't have anything, he's got a couple of dollars, he's going to calculate. He's calculating and tomorrow, all emails and everything. Huh? Telephones, cell phones, here, there. Have people calling them day and night. You think happiness is going to be in the house? Ask those who have big homes. In the cars, ask those who have cars. Where is the happiness? Happiness in the heart. Al-sa'ada fi al-qalb. And al-qalb biyadillah. And al-qalb is with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And in order for you to have happiness in the heart, you have to be with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Then you will be happy. With whatever Allah gave you, you will be happy. But if your heart is not with Allah, then no matter what Allah gives you, you're not going to be happy. لأنه من وجد الله فقد وجد كل شيء. Whoever finds Allah found everything. And whoever does not find Allah has lost everything. We have adab for the recitation of the Quran. Adab on ظاهرة وأداب on باطنة. Apparent adab and concealed adab. أداب ظاهر number one وضوء لا يمسه إلا المطهرون. When you touch this Quran, have your وضوء أداب with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This is the book of Allah. Have أداب with the book of Allah. وضوء. What else? Have sit in خشوع. Sit in humbleness. I'm not saying it is forbidden and haram and incriminating your sin if you extend your leg. It is not. But it is not the أداب. It is not the adab. Don't sit leaning on everything. If you were to sit in front of a king, if I was to take you in front of a king, in front of a president, and you would sit in his majlis, are you going to put your feet like this, and you're going to put your leg up, and you're going to put your hand, and you're going to lean on all walls, or are you going to sit in humbleness listening? You are with the book of Allah. Sit in humbleness. Have خشوع. لو أنزلنا هذا القرآن على جبل لرأيته خاشعا متصدعا من خشية الله. If this book was revealed on a mountain, the mountain itself would have خشوع from Allah سبحانه وتعالى. How come the people's hearts sometimes are more rougher and more closed than a mountain, than a rock?
ثم قست قلوبكم فهي كالحجارة أشد قسوة.
The other thing also that you should have tartil of the Quran. Take your time with the Quran. Waratil al-Quran tartila. Have the tartil of the Quran. This is the book of Allah. Enjoy the book of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Try to feel the mercies with the book of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This is the oasis that you're entering. Read the Quran in your home if you want your children to read the Quran. Don't expect them to do things you don't do. Lead by example. Adab batina. We don't have the time to finish all of it, but I'll say one or two. Thank Allah when you read the Quran. Ihmudillah. Say Alhamdulillah. That what? That you read the Quran? La. Alhamdulillah that Allah enabled you to read the Quran. That Allah enabled you to read His book. Be thankful that Allah gave you the opportunity that you could read His book. Jalla Jalaluhu. La tafrah. بالطاعة لأنها برزت منك. Do not be happy for the obedience because you did it. But be happy because لأن الله أبرزها عليك. But because Allah gave it to you. لا عمل أرجى للقلوب إلا not, there's no deed that's better for the heart except that the deed الذي غاب عن الشهود رؤيته. That you don't see the deed. If you see that you're doing the deed, there is a problem. That you don't see the deed. How come? So that you can become needy to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You're doing the best you can, but you don't know if Allah accepts your deed or not. You're always doubting your niyyah, doubting your ikhlas, so you can better your ikhlas. And getting, not that you doubt that there's a doubt actually, but you're saying that I don't know if Allah accepts my deeds because the ikhlas is not 100% perfect. Until you better your faqr to Allah, needy to Allah. You become needy and needy and needy and needy and needy. So you reach a state where you don't see any of the deeds you do. All your siyam and all your zakah and all your qiyam and all your salah, you do them on the best possible way, but yet you don't see them because you are so needy to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and you're only looking for His mercy. You know your deeds are not going to get you anywhere. Do not depend on the deeds and depend on the Lord of the deeds. That's the point. يا أيها الناس أنتم الفقراء إلى الله. This is the real faqr to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And this is what the anbiya and the awliya were. And this was their khuluq. And this was their seerah. And this was their path on every day. Because if you see your deed, this is the barrier between you and real sincerity. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to make us among those who make every day of Ramadan a day of Quran, even for 5 minutes. Open up the Quran, establish today, tonight, establish a relationship with this Quran you have in your home. Open it up and say, this is a day with you now. I will never leave you till the day I die, so you can come with me to my qabr. So you can lighten my grave, so you can lighten my barzah, so you can lighten my qiyamah. Otherwise, where are you going to go? Make that connection. Give your children the Quran so they can grow with this Quran all the time. So they can it can be beloved to them. Glorify the Quran and glorify the messenger of the Quran and glorify the Lord of the Quran. Allahumma salli ala Sayyidina Muhammad wa ala Muhammad. Kama sallaita ala Ibrahim wa ali Ibrahim. Barak ala Muhammad wa ala ali Muhammad. Kama barakta ala Ibrahim wa ali Ibrahim fil alamin innaka Hamidum Majid. Allahumma ansur al-Islam wal muslimin. A'li ya Mawlana kalimat al-haq wal din. اللهم من أراد بالإسلام والمسلمين خيرا فوفقه إليه من أراد بهم غير ذلك فاجعل دائرة السوء عليه اللهم رد المسلمين إلى دينك ردا جميلا آتي أنفسنا تقواها وزكها أنت خير من زكاها أنت وليها ومولاها اشف اللهم مرضانا وعاف مبتلانا وفك أسرانا وارحم موتانا اغفر اللهم لنا ولآبائنا ولمشايخنا ولمن له حق علينا ولمن على الخير أعاننا وعن الشر أبعدنا ولمن
والدومة
I'm